The screen door slams, Mary's dress waves. Like a vision she dances across the porch as the radio plays. Roy Orbison singing for the lonely. Hey, that's me and I want you only. Don't turn me home again, I just can't face myself alone again. Don't run back inside, darling, you know just what I'm here for. So you're scared and you're thinking that maybe we ain't that young anymore. Show a little faith, there's magic in the night.
We'll be right back. Good morning, everyone. Hope everyone is having a wonderful day. We are ready for the final day of Fall Forum, day four. I hope everyone has enjoyed the first 3 days. And without further ado, I know our lawmakers are very busy. I want to go ahead and introduce them and then kick it off to the senators and then the representatives, and then we'll have some time for questions. We have with us Senator Jessica Garvin. Good morning, Senator. Senator George Young. Representative Carol Bush. Representative Cindy Munson. And Representative Daniel Pay. So, Senator Garvin, why don't you go ahead and kick us off? Basically, the one question I want y'all to start with is, what's the forecast for children in the 2022 legislative session?
Well, good morning, and thank you so much for having me on and for hosting us this morning. I hate going first. I text you and said, let someone else go first, but you didn't get it.
I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. That's a really good question. I think we did a lot of really great work this past legislative session. Some of the things that I am actually focused on for children for the next session are really protections against victimization for sexual assault. Having a husband that works within the foster care system and within child welfare, he and I have been having a lot of conversations recently about children that are victimized that either live in foster care or that have been victimized as far as sexual assault is concerned, that are still in foster care and their likelihood of victimizing someone else. And just, there are so many studies and statistics that show that environment kind of cultivates that behavior. And so my primary focus this next session, and hopefully we can get some good policy passed, will be the protection of our kids, whether that's kids in foster care or kids that have been in foster care that have a likelihood of victimizing someone in the future. So for me, that's really my priority. I know we'll continue to work on education reform and just a lot of other, you know, good policy that is beneficial for our kids and for our families. But that's really where my focus is for this next session. And I'm excited to get to work on some of those policies. I've been working with Rachel Holt with OJA on getting some language together for some legislation. So I'm just going to keep trekking away on that. I know that's very vague, but I am still doing some research and don't want to go into a whole lot of details on some of the things we're working on, but look forward to letting you guys know as soon as I get some final language on some issues.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Young.
Good morning. Thank you again, Joe, for allowing me to come and to be a part of this session. I had an interim study this week, and one of the presenters was Dr. Kirk, who's out at Star Spencer. And so it reaffirmed my idea and thought that one of the most significant things for my district, which is predominantly an African-American district, is the disparities that exist. And she brought those up again. And one of the reasons I had her there for children in my district, and what I hope that OICA will help us look at, is particular areas of our state, in particular my district, where you have some very distinct disparities. Even with the lack of funding that is coming to education, it is still the most significant thing that we can do, and that is to help prepare our children in a safe environment. I agree with Senator Garvin about the safety, but the other thing is we're not giving a good enough product to our young people, our children, who are by law are guaranteed not just a public education, but a good public education. And one of the things that really bothers me, and again, after this week in talking to Dr. Kirk out at Star Spencer, I will be meeting with her, and not only her, but other educators around Senate District 48 to talk about the specific issues that impact my district somewhat differently from other districts. And it seems that even some of the funding that is coming through is not getting through. One of the things she said, and I'll leave it at that because I think you're getting the point of where my push is going to be for this session, is that there are school districts, the school she's at has very few AP course pathways. And there are schools right across town from her that has anywhere from 30 to 40 more pathways than Star Spencer, for one example, one of the schools in my district. So I've got to take a closer look at that and see what I can do to bring attention to the fact that some of the schools in my district are not receiving the same attention and the same appropriations, obviously, as other schools are, because it is very important that we cannot, as they tried to use the tagline some years ago, no child left behind. Well, there are some children that are being left behind. It's not because of their ability. I've seen our children perform at a top level, but that's the problem that I see right now. And so, Joe, that's the thing I'm going to be focusing on that has been brought to my attention.
Thank you, Senator. Representative Pay.
Well, thank you, Joe. Good morning, everyone who's attending the OICA Fall Forum. Great to be with all of you virtually. So when it comes to just my general expectations for next year's legislative session, I think broadly speaking, you know, we're still going to be trying to address some of the long-term impacts we've seen from the pandemic, namely the impact on our education system, how we've seen an increase in teacher shortage the past couple of years, and how to address that. When it comes to mental health, and particularly for our young kids who've been impacted with all the COVID stuff, and then also communication. For example, how do we update our Open Meetings Act to fit the 21st century now that we have more virtual meetings, kind of like this format? And as far as for me specifically, there are a couple of things I'm real excited about. I just got an email here a couple of minutes ago that I'll need to respond to pretty soon. Working with Higher Ed and Career Tech and the Region of Food Bank on a pilot program to have a grant where you can address food insecurity on college campuses. How do we encourage more food pantries to be opened up? How do we better connect students with resources that already exist to help them when it comes to this particular issue? And the other big project I'm excited about is a Family in Need of Services System, FINS. Had an interim study a month ago, and we're trying to work with various stakeholders on when it comes to certain families who have kids who are truants, runaways, disobedience, and maybe expanding that to children who are sexually trafficked and exploited. How do we get them better services to get out of those situations, to help them improve their lives through more oversight, through more accountability, perhaps to the court system? Arkansas had a similar system in place for many, many years, and we're looking at them as a model. And so we're going to be working with OJA, the District Attorney's Council, DHS, all these groups together, and trying to help kids in these types of circumstances. So a lot of things going on, and you know, the pandemic has definitely altered our society in many ways. And so looking at how do we move forward in a productive manner, I think that's kind of going to be the overall trajectory of next year's session.
Thank you, Representative. Representative Munson. You're muted, Cindy.
I knew I was going to do that.
It's inevitable. It happens to all of us at least once.
You know what? At least I broke the ice. So the next person who does it, just know you aren't alone. I was saying good morning and thanks for having me. Always enjoy coming and visiting with everyone. I'll probably just expand on what Representative Pay said and speak from a broader perspective that I think we're all going to have to be focused on how the pandemic has impacted our children and our families, especially when it comes to families around workforce, healthcare, and housing. Those are obviously important aspects of our lives that help us when it comes to living healthy lives and making sure that we're achieving the goals that we want for our children. You know, just the housing crisis alone and everything that we're facing with our constituents. I have many who have lost housing or on the verge of losing housing. And the stories are devastating. And then throughout the pandemic, of course, hearing about employment and folks losing their jobs and just remembering how that trickles down into our families and what happens to our children. Like Representative Pay, I think many of us, both in the Republican and Democratic caucuses, are focused on the mental health of our children and making sure that they have access to the services that are necessary for them to get through this time. I mean, mean, we're all more stressed than normal. There's still a lot that we are navigating, even though it may feel like the pandemic is over, it's not. And I think we're all still trying to figure out how to live normal lives again. I've been reading some articles on just how our brains are processing everything that's going on. And so for children, that's just that much more challenging. And so I'm really going to be focused on ways that we're truly helping our families and finding, I think at this point in time, we have to find bipartisan solutions because these things are not partisan. These are issues that we have all dealt with regardless of what we believe, who we are, and where we live in this state. The pandemic has impacted us. I also serve on the Joint Committee for Pandemic Funding Relief. So ARPA funds, if you've heard about ARPA money, I'm sure everybody has in some capacity. I serve on the Health and Human Services Working Group, and we're having a lot of discussions on what's happened with healthcare around workforce. And then of course, just the services that we're providing currently before the pandemic and where those gaps have been, especially when it comes to early childhood services and how we support children in their early years. So those are things that I will certainly be focusing on and continue to elevate as we go through this next legislative session and doing my best to see where we can bring both sides together to accomplish some good things for our kids in Oklahoma.
And last but certainly not least, Representative Carol Bush.
Well, thank you, Joe, and thank you for putting this together in a great fall forum, by the way. I just gleaned your draft topics. I don't know, what is this, 20 pages? There's a lot of them here. I think you've covered everything. There are so many issues. Sometimes I think it's overwhelming. Legislatively, when we start really looking and drilling down on that. I appreciate all of my colleagues and what they're doing. I want to do a shout out to one of my colleagues, Representative Andy Fugate. He did two interim studies in my committee, which is Children, Youth, and Family Services. One I did with him and one Representative Lawson did. The one that he did with Representative Lawson was a 360-degree view of DHS and where we're going and how we can do business differently to better serve our children. And that is a huge, huge topic. It was a three-hour study, kind of analyzing and looking at everything from foster care to child care to getting out of the Pinnacle Plan, all of those things. So I'm interested in what we're going to do going forward with DHS. And then that afternoon, we followed up with something that I think is really critical for all of our children and families. And that's going to be the, as we talk about IT issues, if you will, shared information in a safe manner, especially for our kiddos that are coming out of foster care and our families. Sometimes we make decisions without really understanding where they've already been or where they're coming from. And I know there's some platforms out there that are being tried. Of course, security being the main issue, not sharing really confidential stuff, HIPAA laws and all that, but our court systems, DHS, OJA, all those different agencies and entities that touch our families need to be able to share information in a timely fashion so that we can better serve these families and these kiddos. I'm real interested to see how we put that together going forward. Of course, that's going, I know that there's some ARPA funding going into technology and broadband and all that. And I know there's a team that's working on the security issues, but I think that's going to be paramount. We've got to quit operating in silos and actually working better together and sharing information so that we can better serve our families. For me personally, I'm going to continue my five-year battle that I've been doing, which is addressing survivors of child sex crimes. Eliminating the statute of limitations, holding those accountable that harbor known pedophiles, and a look back window. Looking at these, I know you had your keynote speaker from Child USA we have some language that would be the gold standard. 23 states have made movements in this arena. We are now in last place. We are not addressing this issue. And it sickens me to believe that Oklahoma continues to be a pedophile-friendly state. We must do something not only to protect our children now, but also to protect those going forward. So I'm really gonna continue that battle until we get that done in Oklahoma. And then finally, I think we've touched on this a little bit and I saw it on your list. I'm gonna continue to work with transportation, public transit, all the different forms. I know, Joe, you and I have had some conversations, especially in our rural areas. Access to care or services, a lot of times depends on transportation. We do have a plan and we need to continue to work that plan and better fund our transit needs so that we can get people to and from where they need to go, whether that be education, healthcare, or actually jobs. So I will continue my work in that area. And then I said finally, but I actually have one more finally. I think it was Representative Munson that talked about the housing issues. I'm actually I've been working with several folks and Representative Bennett on the Landlord-Tenant Act, which hasn't been revised since 1978. We've had both landlords and tenants at the table. I think that you will see some, well, I know you'll see some legislation coming forward to update that so that we can maybe start addressing some of those housing issues that exist, not only in our urban areas, but also in our rural areas. So it's going to be a busy legislative session. And of course, as we all know, it's re-election year for all of us. So we have a lot to do and a lot to accomplish.
Well, I'll admit to the advocates who are on the call, we're very biased. We picked five of our favorites to be on here with us. We appreciate what each of you does for kids, and we know y'all are leading the charge out there, not only in your own caucuses, but with the body and across the state. And we know that that's going to be important, and we have a good, healthy mix of rural and urban on here. I guess the first question I want to ask, and let's go in reverse order. We know there's been a lot of issues that have come about because of the pandemic. We've seen ARPA money coming in. There's been a lot of discussion as far as childcare and other resources. Budget-wise, what are we looking at for 2022? I know it's going to be an election year, and that always makes things controversial. Do you feel like we're going to get to a more stable place using the ARPA funding and honestly just stabilize the economy and the services?
Reverse order, that makes me first.
Yes.
I have not been intimately involved with what's going on at the state level, but I have been here in Tulsa County with the ARPA funds. And before that, even the COVID relief. And our larger counties, I know, are doing some pretty aggressive funding of some things. And what they were looking at was out of the box, creative things with this money. Obviously, there's rules and things around that. And I've been privy to a lot of those proposals. And I think that, I hope the state kind of does what at least Tulsa County has done as far as their parameters and work better together and communicate. I know the city of Tulsa and the county of Tulsa have been communicating on who they're funding and kind of pooling those resources, if you will, to better look at those situations. As far as the state, yes, let's face it, it's an election year. You're not going to see anything monumental as far as revenue in areas. I think you will see more policy development, not necessarily stabilization, if you call it. I do know that also in my committee, we've been looking at this childcare issue. We've got to rethink how we do childcare in early childhood education in this state. I'm part of an NCSL fellowship, and I just did an update a couple of weeks ago. Let me tell you, there are some cool, innovative things going on in other states for minimal amount of money that's really addressing our childcare issues and early childhood. So I'm hoping that that we can continue to be looking at a plan to better serve especially that population, even going forward in an election year.
Representative Munson.
I'm next, making sure I'm not muted. You know, first I'll say the question about will ARPA money stabilize the budget, and the answer, quick answer I would say is no, just because they're one-time funds. And so this is money that will be used specifically for projects or ideas. I'm gonna probably be a little negative here for just a second, but it's one-time money. And if there are projects that are gonna continue on, the entities that are applying for the money are gonna have to find ways to fund those things. Right now, where we are in the process is we're accepting applications, or you can go to oklahoma.gov/ARPA and find the questions where you can submit an idea or you can submit a specific project. The problem, I think, right now is that there's really not a clear vision on what it is that we're trying to spend the dollars on. We have some goals that have been set forth, you know, to us. And of course, we have to follow the federal rules in order to get them to spend the money correctly. But there aren't specific goals that are set out for us to fund programs. And so what I fear is that there will be great projects that will be submitted from all across the state. But I don't know that the things that we fund will all be in alignment with each other. We know that the highest needs in our state right now are centered on the on our workforce. And that includes childcare. It includes healthcare. And what I mean by that is that because we don't have access to quality, affordable childcare, it's really hard to get people back into the workforce. So we have to decide, you know, are we going to fund childcare centers? That's really not how the money is supposed to be used. The money is supposed to be used to, like Representative Bush said, what some of our municipalities and counties may be doing is finding innovative ways to fund services or projects that will help Oklahoma's economy continue and also grow. And I think it's important to remember that $1 billion is not a lot of money when you look at the amount of projects that are being sent to us. We had a meeting, it's probably been almost a month now, where I think we had about 30 projects that have been submitted, and had each of those projects been funded, we would have already spent $1.2 billion if we would have just funded those right then and there. And so I'm not trying to be negative. I think what I'm seeking right now as a committee member and as a member of, you know, the legislature is really looking at, you know, what is our true long-term goal? What are those specific goals that we're trying to accomplish outside of just broadly, you know, making sure we grow our economy and we have innovative ideas, but truly what are we, what is our one focus or two or three focuses that we want to accomplish? I'm sure that'll get more clear as we go along. I try to tell people this in, you know, the different groups that I speak at, is that the truth is that as we get closer to spending the money, the more political it gets. And so being aware of who is on these committees and knowing who has the final decision-making power, it'll be important to try to find ways to communicate with them. But we'll continue to, you know, always speak up and ask questions. I think one thing we can all agree on, regardless of what side of the aisle we're on or what communities we live in, those of us who serve in the community, we know that there are folks who have been disproportionately impacted by the pandemic. And that's really our priority and has to continue to be. So just keep a lookout. If you follow, I'm seeing some names I very much recognize that I think are very involved in what we do at the legislature day to day. But so I would encourage you to help your friends figure out how to sign up for meeting notifications. And so you know when these ARPA meetings are happening because they are all live and they are public. I think it's important for the public to be paying attention to what's going on, so that way we can get your feedback throughout. Even if you don't apply or provide or don't put in an application for a project, letting us know what's happening in your community or in your area of focus is really, really helpful.
Thank you, Representative Pei.
Yeah, I definitely want to echo what Representatives Bush and Munson have said. No doubt that the past 2 years we've seen quite a bit. Federal funds coming down first with the CARES Act, now with ARPA. And then this week, of course, you might see some indication of where issues like the child tax credit, pay family leave are going to be at in Washington, D.C. That's above our pay grades as far as the decision making. But stay tuned for that. You know, I think when it comes to the projects that are funded by these federal funds, you know, they got to be, as far as the scope, not in a way that has to rely on any long-term funding, because these are one-time funds we're talking about when it comes to ARPA and the CARES Act. And that's going to be a discussion that we have to wrestle with as far as the committees and various groups. And I've got a call this afternoon with DHS, with the Children's State Advisory Working Group, and what they're trying to do with when it comes to community investment. So I think everyone with the opportunity to have this money on the table, there is possibility, there is potential, but we just got to be careful with how we spend it and what the scope is as far as projects that the money is going toward. And that's going to be our, as policymakers, our responsibility.
Thank you, sir. Representative Young, Senator Young, Senator Garvin asked if she could go before you. She has to jump into another meeting pretty quick. Is that all right?
You know, my fellow senator can always get a break from me anytime that I can do that for her. I would more than gladly be able to do that. So yes, she can.
Well, I really just don't have a whole lot of things to add. I would just continue to impress upon my just those listening that these are one-time funds, and it is irresponsible, fiscally irresponsible of us to either partially fund projects or fund projects that need sustainable funds that we can't as a state focus on at this time or anytime in the near future. And so although there are going to be some phenomenal projects that I'm sure will be submitted, they're all not going to make the cut. And a lot of that is just due to the fact that it's one-time funds. So I appreciate you letting me go, Senator, but I'll just hand it off to you. And then I have just a few more minutes, so I can possibly take another question if you don't have anything to add.
Well, I will jump in. Let me start off first by saying, let me put forward this. I wish that we had free childcare income indicative. That's the first thing that could help my community. So forget the ARPA funds. If we could do some things that are permanent, that are long lasting, that are long standing, that would be very helpful for my district. I heard the term used a few minutes ago, disproportionately impacted. And my community is disproportionately impacted because of the income. And so first, yeah, the childcare thing, if I could get us to understand how important and significant free childcare would be, income indicative again, for individuals, that would help immensely. Even and the COVID, the problem with COVID is that for my community, we have been dealing with issues of that nature all along. And so COVID only made it even more difficult. So I go back to that. The ARPA funds, I wish that we had more, and this is personal kind of plea. I wish we had more individuals, more groups in our community that were applying for those ARPA funds. And that's part of the problem, trying to get those organizations that are not headquartered in Senate District 48, which is a very big district, but it's a district that does not have those type of organizations. And so we need those. I have an organization, a fraternal group that's coming in that has just trying to get ARPA funds for a community center. That would be great. I've heard their plan plans. I've seen what they're trying to do. It would be a location where children could come and receive that after school and other types of help and assistance that would be immensely, I think, helpful, and that would help stabilize us. I agree with what was said earlier. Any of those one-time funds are dangerous. I know they're useful. They can shoot some folk off into a path that it is an ascending kind of path. But a lot of times those one-time funds, particularly for my community, are there for a minute with some programs that are started. And then after the funds run off, the programs are gone and we're back where we started. We've got to develop some more, I think, long-term plans beyond the ARPA money, beyond what's happening with COVID. COVID only highlights the symptoms that have always existed in a community like my nature. And so that's why my conversation is always different from the rest of the individuals that I serve with, because there are different problems that we have to face. And so you have to start, forget the ARPA funds in my mind. You have to start with, let's talk about this childcare thing. I keep mentioning that because it's very important. The number of parents or single parent homes who are trying to make it. We saw that with COVID, and you get mad at folks who won't go back to work for a wage that is so small that they don't want to go back into that situation. And we get mad at them, and the governor does things like saying, okay, we're going to cut off your funds earlier because we're going to make you go back to a job that is paying less than you need to survive. That impacts our children directly. So, you know, if you're going to talk about stuff that's going to happen, ARPA funds are great. I hope that fraternal organization gets in, they start that center to help us to get some more duties, but we need to start talking about minimum wage increase. We need to start talking about child care. We need to start talking about things that are going to impact our community, particularly my community, in a way. And if you help my community, you help the state of Oklahoma raise the level of any of the negative things that impact us, because that's where it starts. You don't start with the people who already got stuff. You start where it's needed, where it's necessary, where things are being seen as difficult. And so that if you want to stabilize it, if you want to make things great, you know, use some of those ARPA funds to start entities that will be long-lasting and impactful of our not only community, but for our school system, because our schools are the most important thing. Our children are the most important item that we can focus upon. And so that's where I would start. And so I don't have a whole lot of hope around the ARPA funds, because I think they're good. And I've got some entities that will apply for some, but that's not the savior for me.
Thank you, Senator. And want to talk about, honestly, what we're looking at for the upcoming election year. Advocates always want to get involved, but they're also fearful of getting involved for conflict, doing something that might violate the law with tax laws under their nonprofit. I want each of you to talk about some ways that the advocates on here can get engaged, not only through the legislature as far as promoting ideas, but also through the elections. I know probably most people in here love all of y'all. So how can people be more engaged? Because I get the feeling this election coming up, we're going to need to make sure our voices are heard for the advocates out there. And Senator, let's start with you.
Thank you, Joe. You know, I'm sitting on another Zoom call this afternoon with the Oklahoma nonprofit, state of Oklahoma nonprofits, to talk about that very issue, his advocacy for nonprofits. And I think they do have a voice. I think they do have a vital voice, because obviously when you talk to someone like me in the state Senate, I don't have very much of a voice there to dictate or to even have some things happen. And so I hope that the nonprofits will come on board to do some things, to start looking at the areas that they work in. They have a firsthand view of the needs. And so the advocacy piece for them, I don't think it is as, we talk about it as close cut, and OICA is not as close cut as people want to make it. I think I hear what OICA wants. They come and they talk to me. We work together on things. We work together with a lot of different entities, nonprofit agencies that I think are speaking a voice to help do it. And I think that voice is important and significant. And I don't, you know, the concern of crossing some line does not exist for me when it comes for the welfare of our state. And so I hope that nonprofits will become more vocal, because I see them as being more helpful, going back to what I said earlier, more helpful in stabilizing our communities, particularly some of our most needful communities, than going through the legislative process. Because I think it, sad to say, that the legislative process, which is the representative process, sometimes lack the ability to respond to the needs of the folk that they represent, and particularly to the needs of the folk that they sometimes don't represent, but make laws and make statutes that impact those communities. And so I hold out. I love nonprofits. That's where I got, you know, obviously a pastor in the community, but also with nonprofits. I love nonprofits because I think they make a difference. And if they can speak a louder voice, I think it would be more helpful, particularly to our children and to their future. And so I hope we will get more advocacy out of our nonprofits and take a bigger part in it, and take a bigger risk, if you want to put it that way.
Representative Pay, Senator Garvin had to drop off. So the four of y'all are taking charge over the last 30 minutes here.
That means sounds good. Democratic stuff about her, and she can't do anything.
So you mentioned next year being an election year, and I think the first point I want to make is, you know, with the U.S. Census from last year, every 10 years we have what is called redistricting. And this past year was different in that we didn't get the complete data set until August. Normally we get that in April. And so what's happening is we're going to go into a special session on November the 15th. Solely focused on wrapping up redistricting for our congressional, for our five congressional districts and all 101 House districts and 48 Senate districts. Overall, Oklahoma has seen a population growth of about 200,000 people. So we're just under 4 million as a state. And if you look at the specific communities, some have seen growth, some have seen loss. And so that's impacting the way that the boundaries are going to be drawn for each of our districts. And so we should know here in about a month what the final lines look like for next year's elections. And I think for the most part, we're all going to see some changes, and we'll get some new neighborhoods, lose some neighborhoods, just depending on where the population was impacted. And as far as your question about advocacy, you know, I think I'm a big believer in in-person, face-to-face, you know, coffee conversations. So I encourage each of you, reach out to your representative, to your senator, have that meeting with them. And the Capitol is open. And next year, all the renovations should be complete. The new paint, everything that looks fantastic. And so I encourage you to visit the Capitol if you have a chance and meet with your legislators directly there. And I also think when it comes to whatever form of communication you're comfortable with, whether that's email, phone call, Facebook message, these are the ways that I personally communicate with constituents. And I try to be flexible in how people reach out. But we definitely want to hear from you. This is how we can be better representatives. I know everyone gets excited whenever there's an election coming up, we campaign, et cetera. But the real work is during the governing part. I think we're kind of in this perpetual campaign mode as a country, but we got to focus on governing and getting things done. That's where the real work happens. So if you don't know, you know, look up your representative, your senator, get to know them. And then, of course, if you're not satisfied with how they're responding, with the not accessible, that's what campaigns are for, to hold us accountable and to perhaps look for different options if that's not the case. So I just say, you know, main point is elections, they come and go, but it's really when it comes to governing and policy making, I just wish there was more focus on that as a society. I know it's not as sexy or exciting when it comes to campaigns, when it comes to legislating, but it's very important work that we do in that respect.
Representative Munson.
First, I just want to say that I put my contact information in the chat because this is the last question I'll be able to answer because I got to get on the road for a meeting that's outside of Oklahoma City. But first, something that I failed to mention early on, which I have no idea how I let it bypass my mind, but you know, I think many of you are aware or at least working on the DDS waiting list. And that's been you know, a huge topic of conversation at the Capitol for a while. Now, but specifically during this interim, there was a Loft meeting and Loft report that was made public about how the Department of Human Services is working through the waiting list. And I certainly raised concerns around where the money is going and who it's serving based on those appropriations that we have made over the last few years. And then also what this process is going to look like as Liberty, the group that DHS has hired to take assessments of families who are waiting. And so that will certainly be a priority for me. I know for Senator Kurt, I know many on this call that will be focusing on the waiting list and figuring out how we get these services to our families, especially our children. So I just wanted to make sure I elevated that. I have no idea how I let it, like I said, bypass the question that was asked earlier. And then the second thing on how to be a little more engaged, first I'll say, I think most of you know, but if you don't know, prior to entering politics, I worked in nonprofit. I worked for the Girl Scouts, and most of my work was centered on outreach and getting into communities where Girl Scouts was not traditionally provided for girls in our families. And so there is where I really started to understand more fully the criminal justice system and how it impacts our families. And then also just issues that we've been talking about, housing, employment, food insecurity, access to healthcare, those kinds of things. I was serving girls and families who they just kept bumping into multiple challenges. And so it really opened my eyes, you know, and coupled with my own personal experience, just how important it is for nonprofits and those of us who are close to these situations, how important it is that we advocate for ourselves and for the people that we serve. I think nonprofits more than anyone else knows what's going on the ground because we're the ones finding the solutions for the problems that our communities are facing. And so we know better than anyone. And it allows us to kind of take away the partisanship so you're able to talk about some of these issues that may seem more, I think sometimes seem more democratic, but really are just human issues and values that are important to our community that should be elevated to those who are making policy. And so just like what Representative Pay said, you know, go to the okhouse.gov website, punch in your email, or excuse me, your address, and figure out who your state representative and state senator is. Many of you probably already know, but if you don't, make sure you do that. And then make sure your colleagues are doing that and figure out ways to have conversations with us. And I know to Joe's point, you do have to be careful about your 501c3 status and making sure you're not lobbying or, you know, using your organization for campaign reasons. But I think there's a lot of ways you can work around that. And more than anything, you are a constituent of ours. You live in our districts. And so, you know, contacting us and having a conversation, introducing yourself, telling us who you are, what the work it is that you're doing. We lean on people in our districts to, you know, face the problems that we're seeing at the Capitol and how we can accomplish those goals and reducing those challenges. The second thing I will say, you know, many people think that they can't or shouldn't or don't belong helping when it comes to campaigns, and I wholeheartedly disagree. There's always something someone can do when it comes to our reelection campaigns. If there are folks that you want to support and want to see stay at the state capitol who are actually working on solutions and fighting the good fight, whatever that looks like for you, knocking doors, you know, giving donations, no donation is too small, but really getting on the ground. I think it's such a great experience for people, whether they want to run for office or not, is to get into the neighborhoods and go door to door with us or with our campaigns and to see, you know, what it is that we're hearing and how people interact with us face to face. And it's a great way to kind of get out of the political bubble and really get to know about the issues in our community. And what I love is the volunteers, some who do end up running for office, but then also I have volunteers who get involved in different things because they start to see just a bigger picture in terms of and seeing where it is that they fit to make a difference. And I think that's always valuable, whether you're, you know, whether your candidate wins or not, there's always something that you can gain from helping on campaigns. I've been helping on campaigns ever since I was in high school. And even at one point worked with Joe Dorman on some campaigns. And I was a volunteer as a college student, and just learned so much about what it means to connect with people, regardless of party affiliation, and just what we can do for our communities when we really connect as Oklahomans and human beings. So I do have to go, like I said, but I just want to say thank you to Joe, and thank you to my colleagues, Representative Pay and Bush, and of course, Senator Young, my former seatmate, for all the things that they do. I think all of us, and Senator Garvin as well, she and I had a great impromptu conversation about how we can address the waiting list issue. And so take heart that there are people who are friends, truly friends, and try to find solutions to the problems that we face. Even though it may look like we're disagreeing all the time, we do try to find ways to help the children in our state. And I count each of them as close friends and certainly appreciate the work that they do. So I hope the rest of the day is great. Is there a chili cook-off tonight?
It's going on at lunchtime. If you want to swing through and grab some on your way out of town, feel free to.
I'll already be gone. But good luck. Good luck. I appreciate it. Thank you, Joe. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for what you do, too.
Thank you, Madam Leader-elect, and thank you for making me feel old.
Oh, yeah. Well, just a reminder, don't forget about me, Joe.
Oh, the good old days of hunkered down in the campaign headquarters.
Yeah. All right. Bye, everyone.
Representative Bush.
Okay. Well, I have lots to say on this subject. It's, first of all,
been strategic in saving you for last on this one.
I know, right? Well, first of all, I've had many, many careers, and I've been a state employee, a city county employee, I've run a nonprofit, I've had my own business. And as far as getting involved in advocacy, there's always avenues of doing that. When I ran the nonprofit I did here in Tulsa, we actually, I don't know if the laws have changed, but I filed and received a 501H, which, because it was a 501c3 I was the ED of, and the H allowed us that 20% of our time could be spent advocating, if you will, for whatever. And it just so happened I was pretty involved with the criminal justice issues. So I don't know, your nonprofits ought to check with your attorneys, because that gives you some cover there. There's some documentation that you have to make, but you know, that's okay. At least you have that opportunity. The same thing happened when I was at the City County Health Department and the State Health Department. At City County, we were going for an ad valorem increase. And then when I was at the state, I was really involved with our first anti-tobacco legislation. Now, that meant I was spending a lot of time either with our city council, county governments, or at the Capitol. So what I had to do was, there's paperwork. So again, I had to clock out of my job, keep track of all those yellow slips, and then clock back in when I wasn't advocating. And of course, being careful not to use state or city computers, phones, and all that. So there are ways to do it and be involved. You just got to know what the rules are and then do it. That's number one. Number two, there is a huge, huge push in most of my legislation. I really try to keep this in focus, of public-private partnerships. We cannot expect the state to solve all these issues. And I know, I think all the representatives and senator have touched on this. It really starts at home, our communities, our local communities, the boots on the ground, front line. And a lot of times those are our nonprofits. There's definitely an avenue for conversations and also opportunities for those private public partnerships. If we all pool our resources together, we will have a greater impact on the communities that we serve. It also helps us to look at, I'm from an urban area, but I'm a huge proponent in how we can better help our friends in rural Oklahoma that don't have access to those services. So public-private partnerships are going to be very important. And hearing from the boots on the ground, which is our frontline people that are actually hands-on with the communities we serve, is imperative that we hear from them. Third, this year, for the first time after 5 years, was the first time I had people coming into my office, which is, by the way, not only unethical, I think it's illegal, saying, hey, you know, we voted for you, we funded your campaign, we need you to vote this way. Okay, those for me are fighting words. Never shall the two ever meet. I was just dumbfounded that was happening. And of course, just fueled my fire to go, fine. For that reason alone, I'm not voting for what you want. I just found that extremely offensive. Like Daniel Pay, my friend, Representative Pay said, what I like better is sitting down having coffee face to face. Don't come in and threaten me with any type of, whether it's funding or campaign promises or whatever it is. That's not how we get things done. It's sitting down and having a conversation and creating a win-win. We're not going to all get 100% of what we want. But if we can figure out how to better navigate the systems and work better together where everybody gets a little bit of a win, I think that's how we better serve our different communities, no matter what the subject matter is. As advocates, I can tell you right now, there's many of us that when you do those one-click politics or form letter emails, we throw those away. I don't even answer them. If you can't take the time to actually email me or call and tell me what you think, as opposed to a signing on to something that just is a spam email, then I don't have time for that. That's not real advocacy. Real advocacy is where you come to us and talk about what's keeping you up at night and what you need to better serve the community that you're serving. I always tell this story, so if you've heard it before, I apologize. When I first ran the Hidden Predator Act, I had three bills associated with that. And there were a group of women that were in the master's program here at OU Tulsa, and they reached out to me, and we scheduled and went to lunch. And they had put together information how one of the bills was actually going to be detrimental to child sex survivors. Sex abuse survivors. So I pulled the bill. They were shocked by that. Well, the reason being is I don't know everything. So posting on social media or sending out a form letter isn't going to change my mind. But having that conversation where they'd done the research, they were right. It was a bad piece of legislation and didn't need to happen. It wasn't going to change the trajectory of what we were trying to do with the other two pieces of legislation. So, yeah. We do want to hear from you, and there's a way to do that, and we want to partner with you. Whatever we do at the Capitol, you all are the ones that usually have to implement it or stay within those guidelines. So it's imperative that you talk to us and tell us what the reality is as you deal and navigate whatever your system is that you are advocating for. But don't be afraid of us. We're people too. We're taxpayers too. And really, we want what's best for our communities. It's not about being reelected or being financially supported. It's about doing what's right. And I'll just go out on a limb. If you've got a candidate that's all about being reelected and not doing their job, then they don't deserve to be there.
Very, very good point. We've only got about 6-7 more minutes left, so I want to allow a couple of minutes for you all to each close up. I want to make sure the advocates understand how important their voice is and why it's important for them to communicate to their lawmakers and to lawmakers working on similar issues. I know, Carol, you're working on the legislation which our keynote speaker brought up last week. How can these advocates help you with the issues that you're working on that you talked about earlier? And how can they get better engaged with the the mission at the Capitol? How can they make sure their voices are heard better, other than obviously working with OICA?
Well, of course, working with OICA and supporting you is paramount. But the other part of this is, you know, there's 101 of us in the House. And I'd say for the most part, we really do listen to our constituents. So when you have something like the keynote speaker, what we're looking at, which is huge. I mean, I am telling you, this piece of legislation is huge. Part of it, it may be unconstitutional, but it will at least get the conversation going on what we need to do to change the laws and the Constitution in order to better protect people. So hearing from me with my legislators' buddies, I mean, yeah, those that respect me, they're like, yeah, okay, here she comes again. What's more important is if you believe and support what I'm trying to do with that legislation or any piece of legislation, you have your tentacles, if you will, out in different communities. Representatives especially want to hear from their constituents. So, Mike, this one particular piece of legislation, trying to identify survivors of child sex crimes in every county would be really important for them, if they're willing to tell their story, to call the representative and senator and go, hey, this happened to me and you need to know the perpetrator is still out there doing this to kids. That's going to be more impactful than me just going door to door as a representative from Midtown Tulsa saying this is important because I've talked to these people. They want to hear from their representatives. This piece of legislation, when I started it 5 years ago, came from a constituent, wasn't even a constituent, but she lived here in Tulsa. And currently the main advocate behind this is in Norman. She's not even my constituent because I believe that this is an Oklahoma problem, Oklahoma issue. So you all as advocates trying to help us find people in the different districts that are willing to speak to that issue firsthand is what's going to be most impactful. When we worked on the public transit bill, and I give this example too quite often, we had all the different transit providers do ride-alongs. They invited the representatives and senators to get into the community and ride along on the van, the disabled van, maybe, you know, whatever it was, Tulsa Transit. We got on the big bus. This forced representatives and senators to actually get to know the constituents and how difficult sometimes use of public transit is. That's how we got that bill passed 94-0 out of the House, and I think it was 45-0 out of the Senate. Because they participated back home where it matters. So that's really how you can move forward and help us the most on legislation that you see that is real important to you all.
Thank you. And you just got a shout out from Rebecca Hubbard over in the chat. Be sure and check that out. Representative Pay.
Yeah, and since we're closing down, to wrap things up, you know, number one, for all of you, it's important that we all stay engaged with the process, not just when there's an election coming up, but from beginning to end, especially as we're in the middle of policymaking. That's where things get done. And then second, I just want to emphasize that, you know, as elected officials, we are human beings, and that means we are imperfect. We don't know every single thing about every single policy issue. And so I think if you're a good legislator, you're open-minded and ask for help and try to learn from other experts and people who are in the relevant field. And then as well, for some reason as a society, we've kind of gotten to a point where it's like if a person, an elected official, they vote against something that you agree with, it's like you got to hate that person. To me, I don't think you should hate someone just because you have different opinions and different viewpoints. I think one of the things that makes this country so great is that we have diverse perspectives and we can all work together and find common ground. We cannot lose that ability in the future. That's how we can function as a democratic republic. So yeah, you're going to have times where, you know, we make some conclusions and decisions that you might have a different opinion on. That doesn't mean we should stop working together. You know, there's always going to be things in the future where we will have agreement and we got to work on the same page. And the last point I want to make is that don't be discouraged if you have an idea, a bill, and it doesn't get through the first session. What I've learned during my time in the legislature is that really meaningful change takes time. It may take 1, 2, 3 legislative sessions, but you should not give up just because it doesn't work out the first time. If you're really passionate about an issue, if you have a vision, you need to keep working diligently to see across the finish line. And to me, that's what makes this process so fun, is because you have to build coalitions, you have to bring people together, you have to advocate, and it is so rewarding in the end when you do get it accomplished and you do make a positive difference for Oklahomans. So I've still got a lot of energy, a lot of passion, and look forward to continuing to work with all my colleagues in the House and the Senate.
Thank you, Senator. Closing us out.
Well, thank you, Joe. You know, I was thinking as people were talking, it's very fortunate I'm back in the pulpit again. And on yesterday, I spoke at a church and I got stopped about 6 or 7 times by individuals who wanted to talk to me about issues that impact our state, in particular the community that I operate in. And so I'm very fortunate in that I have access, and in the pulpit every Sunday, I have access to individuals who are living through the things that we legislate. And so they are able to give me a firsthand, timely report of what's going on. And I think that's invaluable for me. The fact, again, that I came out of nonprofit work as a pastor, but being involved on nonprofit boards, United Way, Red Cross, Leadership Oklahoma City, Leadership Oklahoma, all of those boards helped me to try and understand not only the broader view of a statewide things that impact, but also helped me to concentrate once again as state senator for Senate District 48 to look at Northeast Oklahoma City, Northwest Oklahoma City, parts of those, that, and say to my constituents, I'm taking what they're saying and bringing it to you, and this is what we need to do. This is what you need to do. And so I've never had much of a problem with contact and communication in my district, because for the very reason that I'm in the pastorate again, I'm seeing them all the time. And that is very beneficial to me. That gives me this hand, finger on the pulse kind of thing weekly and daily, because, you know, I keep a pocket full of cards and my cell phone number is on my card. And when I give them to them, I tell them to give me a call, to contact me, and people take me up on that to my chagrin sometime at the most inawkward times to call, but they do. And that's great. I appreciate that. And so my thing is, I hope, because I look at the individuals who are on this call, and my point once again is, you know, I need us to think broadly, because there are some missing pieces, even from the people that I like to go through and see who's on the call, on this call. There are some missing pieces. There are some concerns that may not be brought up. And part of what I try to do is bring up those concerns from my perspective, because that is very important to the whole state. Because I will say again, if you do one thing and start concentrating on the areas that we have the most severe problems in, the areas that are economically depressed, the areas that seemingly sometimes are forgotten, left out, and not have the voice because we don't have individuals who are grouping together to talk about those things. And that's what I would ask you to concentrate on. And don't, you know, I don't want to be the lone siren John the Baptist in the wilderness, the only voice that's crying out. Remember, there are other people are being impacted and impacted in ways differently, not more severely, but differently, and in some cases more severely than those of you who sometimes deal with folk. And so that's all I would ask, is make that consideration. But I appreciate my district. I appreciate the people in my district so much because I'm a part of it, and they see me as a part of it. And so they include me in things and outside of that. So I'm satisfied with that. I'm less satisfied with the process at 23rd and Lincoln. I'm more satisfied with the process of what my district is giving me and how they support me and how they inform me and keep me abreast of those things that's important to them. So thank you, Joe, for allowing me to be able to be a part of this and to express, I think, sometimes a different perspective. And I appreciate the work that you're doing at OICA.
Absolutely, Senator. Thank you. And Christine said you were on fire yesterday, so you got a shout out this morning.
Thank you, Chris. That's my daughter, so she got to say that. Yeah.
Well, the three of you that are on here, thank you so much for everything y'all have done. Each of you have worked on issues. You worked on interim studies this summer. Of course, Jessica and Cindy had to drop off. All five of you, we consider very near and dear to our hearts at OICA. And thank you. And I know with Potts Family Foundation, with the Early Childhood Caucus, all of y'all have been involved with that and truly have a heart for kids. So we really appreciate each of you for taking the time today. And if you would.
Thank you, Joy.
What's on your mind today?
Oh. Thank you, Joe. Thank you, Joe.
I couldn't resist.
I know, right? Thank you.
All right. Hey, and we have t-shirts from the Chili Cook-Off and the conference for each of you. So I'll be emailing you for your sizes as a thank you gift. And here's what they look like. If you can see it on the screen, they turned out pretty good.
Make sure you get one big enough for these abs, man.
Hey, guns.
There you go. There you go. That's all I want to make sure. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you all very much. Hope everyone enjoyed that conversation. Just part of this, we wanted you to hear from some of those who we consider like-minded souls who care about most of the issues. And of course, each issue is going to be different. Concerns with the districts may have a different take on each bill. And that's why we have 101 representatives, 48 senators working on these different policies. And speaking of working on policies, I hope everyone got the document that we emailed around that had your suggestions that came from the breakouts that we had with each of you discussing the main four policy areas. Peyton has put together some of these ideas in a Jamboard. I am going to share my screen so everybody can take a look at that. And we want you to go ahead, and Peyton, if you will put the Jamboard. Oh, you already did. Put the Jamboard in the, there we will go ahead and get started. And here, if everyone can see my screen, we've got this broken down by the different topics. Want each of you to read through and look at the document we emailed around to you. And just, we want to take about 25 minutes going through here, having you look at these areas and seeing if this will summarize well to our board as we put together the working document. We're going to have a press conference coming about hopefully within the next couple of weeks to share these ideas with the public and certainly present them to lawmakers before the bill filing deadline comes up. So Peyton, I want to turn it over to you to just let you talk a little bit about the Jamboard.
Yes, Joe, will you stop sharing your screen so I can share mine and just make sure everyone knows? Thank you.
You got it.
So for those of you who have joined us the last few days, know how to work the Jamboard. Sorry, I'm trying to. There we go. However, for those of you who are just now joining us and have never used a Jamboard, I'm going to explain how to do that really, really quick. So each page is one of the four topics that we have been discussing. So we've got mental health and physical health, economic stability for Oklahoma families, child welfare and juvenile justice systems, and technology use and broadband access. And so if you do not see an idea on the draft that Joe sent out and you would like for an idea to be included in that document, just click this little sticky note, type your idea out, save it, and it'll be on the Jamboard.
I want everybody just to read through the document and just to look at the different parts of what we've included in there. We hope we touched on your points of what you submitted in the sticky notes as we went through those Jamboard conversations last week, and want to hear from you on your ideas right now if there's anything we need to add in. And if you're not able to access the Jamboard, type it into the chat and we will transfer it over to the Jamboard.
Joe, do you want me to share my screen with the Jamboard, or do you want to share the draft?
Let's share the draft so people can look at it again. So we've got on here under the first topic, we had four different topics, mental and physical health. And we asked the question, how can Oklahoma improve access to quality food and physical activity for the state's youth. And then we had each of the post-it notes that y'all submitted. And then the next one was on reducing suicide rates and ideas you shared. And these were some tremendous ideas y'all put together. And if y'all don't have any other further, we'll go ahead and move on to the next one. So on economic stability for Oklahoma families, I want your take on that. Whoops. We had investment through workforce development, workforce industry and licensing and reciprocity, ARPA funding to support childcare, ensure low-income families have healthy food access, juvenile and criminal justice systems, restructuring Oklahoma's tax systems, improve health insurance rates for children, removing barriers for transportation, access to healthcare, safety and quality of life needs. I hope with the silence on the Jamboard, that means everyone thinks that we have a very comprehensive document because we tried to include all of your ideas that you suggested. And Carolyn shared in the chat, yes, state statutes that need to be changed to be less traumatic to children that are child abuse, i.e. child age restriction for alternative witness in case of child abuse. That's one of the things too. We've got some wonderful child advocacy centers around the state that work when these kids are brought into the system after an issue's happened where law enforcement is brought in, usually something impacting the child. They will do a forensic interview to visit with the child and find out what the traumatic situation was. So anything we can do to help out in those traumatic situations when kids are brought into one of the centers, as a result of an issue with law enforcement bringing them away from the family, we need to do what we can to make sure that there are opportunities there.
Joe, we have a couple of ideas submitted in the Jamboard. There's one on page one and another one on page three.
Excellent. On page one, mandated suicide prevention training for all school employees. That's wonderful. And there has been some topics of conversation along those lines with the legislature. And so that is something certainly needs to be brought forth, as with everything that we've been seeing as a result of the pandemic and isolation, that's going to be very important. And we certainly appreciate the lawmakers putting forward more funds. We appreciate Superintendent Hoffmeister building up a counseling corps for the schools. We know a lot of that's going to go very well. And Brittany, thank you very much for the compliments on this. We just put thoughts on paper from what the advocates shared over the last few days. So we appreciate the hard work each of you put in for those thoughts. As Peyton said, looking over on three on the child welfare and juvenile justice systems, adjust the statute of limitations in Oklahoma. I know that is music to Carol Bush's ears. I know that's something that we will be pushing forward this next session. So I want to see what other ideas we have on here. And if you want to go over to any of those, please just flip through one, two, three, and four, submit your ideas. And this Jamboard will be up all day. So if you have ideas as you're reading through the document we emailed out, something may come to you later on, just please throw your suggestions our way and we will put this into a document and get it out to our board, and then we'll email it out to everybody and we'll let you all know when the press conference will be. And we will certainly work to reach out to lawmakers to suggest these ideas and see which ones we can get moving forward that have a policy solution as far as state law. We'll also share with the state agencies to see if agency rules can monitor some of these things and possibly change them. And if there's a federal policy, we'll send it up to the federal delegation. I'll tell you what, I am going to put on a little music, let you all take a 15-minute break if you want, but go through here and read these ideas and throw out your suggestions on this. We wanted to leave this as our final portion to make sure that we're on the right track with this document. Reload the CD and we'll get some music going, and we'll come back in here at 10:30 for our next workshop. So thank you all for all the work you put in, and we'll be back in just a few minutes. We'll get the music loaded here in a second as soon as I can figure out how to do it. Sorry if you're having to sit here in silence. And we'll be back right at 10:30. All right. I hope everyone has had a good break, and we are coming up on the end. We have two wonderful workshops left in store, and we're very thankful to have three of our good friends, Rollo ICA, presenting on some of the work that they're doing. And I'll let Linda kick things off talking a little bit about the initiative that was undertaken by the Potts Family Foundation. OICA was pleased to be a part of this. Last year, Anthem worked with OICA to distribute $15,000 worth of funds to support trauma-informed care work across the state. And the board decided that $10,000 of the $15,000 would go to Potts for the work with NearScience and the work that's being done to do trainings to get people out across the state, train the trainers, so to speak. And we have with us Linda Manaw, who's the Director of Communications and Program Support with the Potts Family Foundation. We also have Dr. Lana Beasley, Assistant Professor of Human Development and Family Sciences at Oklahoma State University, and Cheryl Stepp, who is a trainer consultant for Creating Resilience, LLC. So Linda, I want to go ahead and kick it off to you, and we'll hear from the three of you.
Joe, we've got a pretty tight presentation, so I'm just going to go ahead and let Lana get it started, and then we'll do some wrap-up at the end that talks about our engagement and how people can connect with us, if that's okay.
Certainly.
Thanks for having us.
We are so excited to be here today to speak to you all about this really important topic of the NearScience, and we're just going to jump right in. So I know all of you have a great understanding of ACEs and this great studies done, but you know, I feel like we can never talk about this enough, and I feel like every time I hear about it, every time I speak about it, something else really resonates, or I think about something a little bit differently. So as you can see from this slide, this is just kind of an overview of the ACEs study. And just a reminder, the ACE study really confirmed with scientific evidence that adversity early in life really does increase things like physical, mental, and behavioral problems later in life. And I know all of you in this meeting know that. But the ACE study really was the largest of its kind. With, you can see on the slide, over 17,000 participants. It was developed and co-sponsored by Kaiser Permanente of San Diego and the CDC. And Dr. Vincent Folletti and Dr. Rob Anda were the co-principal investigators of the ACE study. And it really was designed while he was working as a senior scientist at the CDC. And we always want to say that he has reviewed, Dr. Anda has reviewed and approved all this information from the study that we're going to be sharing with you today. But before we talk about the ACEs study, I think it's really important to first talk about the body. And a huge part of the body we know is the brain. And that's why we like to use the term brain health as often as we can, because the brain is connected to all other parts of the body. The human central nervous system really does connect us to ourselves, to other people, and of course, the world around us. And the central nervous system consists, of course, as you can see in this photo, the brain, the spinal cord, and that really integrates all of our senses and information from these receptors all over our body. It really does regulate all those internal body functions, and it manages this elaborate chemical and electrical signaling system. And the nervous system considers sensory input in the context of each and every second, almost instantaneously. And from that, it determines our understanding of and response to the world that we live in. So cells in the nervous system are called neurons, and they are stunningly effective at processing and transmitting information. And they really have a central purpose in doing this. And that is to adapt in ways that keep us alive. And this is going to be important as we talk more. I also always want to say at this part in the presentation that Dr. Martin Teicher of Harvard University reviewed and approved all of the brain science facts we're talking about in this presentation. And I love this next slide because it really does start to make the sort of the brain developing come to life. So you can see on the far left, we see a set of brain cells or neurons, what they might look like at the time of birth. And there aren't a lot of connections, right, between these cells, because when babies are born, they only have the connections and the brain functions they need at that point in life. And I have a 13-month at my house, so I can remember clearly when they were first born, my sweet Max. He just needed to do things like cry when he needed things, right? Voice, but he didn't have to do all the complex thinking that my 9 and my 12-year-old need to do. So it just makes sense that we had this little bit of synaptic connections at birth. But as you move along to the right, you can see most of this wiring of our brain really does occur after life experiences. So by age 6, when you're looking at that middle part, these same brain cells have tons of connections, and the wiring of the brain, or the making of these complex neural networks, is again experience dependent, which is so important. So what gets experienced the most is going to lead to more robust connections. And what doesn't get experienced oftentimes dies off. And so this is really called branching or arborization when you're having these connections being made. And then when you have certain cells die off, that's called pruning, if those experiences aren't happening at a high rate. And then when you see the last at puberty, you can sort of see this pruning happening, because this represents a brain at the time of puberty. And notice there are now fewer connections than there were at 6, because these were, again, those least experienced connections. So this is important to think about, because think about the brains of children that might be exposed to different types of environment. And I love this explained even more on this next slide. So I love that we have these two paths that we're going to talk about. And on the top path, what we see is we see this more dangerous path, right? This path that's a little bit more difficult. And on the bottom, we see more of a benevolent path, a world that's a lot safer, a lot kinder. And we know everyone's life experiences are different, and we don't get to decide what path we're on, right? Oftentimes we're born into the path in the world that we live in. And we know, looking at these paths, especially that top one, we know traumatic experience during development, things like abuse and neglect and even chaotic relationships, really are going to generate sort of predictable patterns of brain architecture, behavior, and traits in young children. So humans are only really made to be under stress for about 20 minutes at a time. And that's long enough to prepare for that fight or flight, which we're going to talk about more in just a second. So experiences that cause stress chemicals to be continuously produced, for example, again, child abuse, neglect, being in a war zone, have a huge impact on development, because it has a huge impact on the brain. So under these circumstances, our bodies really do tend to prepare for life in this more dangerous world, or this top path. And we know when we're in this path that's much more dangerous, stress hormones are being released, and they exert on cells, chemical and wiring, this negative impact. So they sculpt the brain that's wired for certain characteristics, things like being edgy, hot-tempered, impulsive, or even hypervigilant. They also can make us feel withdrawn, numb, disassociated. And this again is that path on the top of the slide. So just to tell you a little bit differently, people who are really exposed to traumatic stress from conception, think about toddlers when they're first born, will likely have a higher baseline of the stress hormone known as cortisol. So it really does start impacting them at a really young age. So as a result, we see these children may have a very short fuse, even as they get into adulthood. They may be more self-focused, and they may have difficulty shifting gears and thinking differently, and it might be harder for them to problem solve. So if there's more danger around the corner, this just makes sense, right? They're trying to survive. Being focused on others and thinking through options probably wouldn't contribute to survival. Instead, they need to be ready for danger in their world. Now, the downside of this is that when hormones like cortisol really hang around for a long time, they actually can be toxic, like I said before, to brain cells. And this toxicity includes making it difficult for brain cells really to develop healthy neural networks. And it can even cause brain cells to die. And this is why we call this continuous stress, trauma, and this episodic, unpredictable stress, that's why we call this toxic stress. So Dr. Teicher says the lower path, again, is this benevolent world path. And again, this world is just kind, easygoing, helpful, and really free from traumatic stress. And people growing up in this path are more likely to develop a brain with cells and wiring and chemistry for being focused, flexible, and relationship oriented. But I want us to think a little bit more about sort of how the brain reacts to all these different things. So this is a great picture of a little person on a walk. And as you can see, they're in a walk in the woods and they have ran into a snake. And I don't know about you guys, but I absolutely do not like running into snakes. So you can see this child is going into that fight or flight response. And what's important to note in the next slide, you'll see that child's on a walk and they're nervous because they've seen a snake before. So they don't even see anything that could be a snake, but they're worried. In the next slide, you can see how even something like a stick could be sort of misrepresented as a snake. Because again, their bodies are ready. They're in that top path where they're ready for a dangerous world on this walk. And you can see on the next slide, you can see how this works. So when the child sees the snake, their brain really does go into that fight or flight. It's releasing cortisol like we talked about before. The great thing is when the threat's removed, right? Or if they see it's not a snake, it's just a stick, their body can calm down and they can go back to normal. What we see oftentimes though with children and adults that have been exposed to extreme trauma, extreme stress, the body never gets to go back to normal. So they're on this constant alert, right? That something bad's just around the corner. There are snakes everywhere. And as we talked about in those previous slides, this can actually be toxic to the brain because there's this constant cortisol, this constant fight or flight response going on in the body. And as you can see in the next slide, we know the brain develops from the bottom up. So we get the most primitive skills first. So we learn basic survival. We talked about when a baby's born, they only need the things to survive. And then as they get older, it becomes more complex what the brain develops. Things like rational thought, planning, and abstract thinking. As you can imagine, when you think about that slide with the brain, age 6 was in the middle and there was all this, right, all these connections. And that's when a child starts school. They need to have more ability to think through things. So I know I said this before, but it's so important. So we had to have another slide. As you're seeing that brain develop in this beautiful picture of the brain and all these connections and arrows, we have to remember that the brain develops by forming connections, and interactions with a caregiver are critical to brain development, because the more times something happens with a child, that's the stronger that connection gets. So that's why when I'm working with families, I always say, you can't say I love you too much to a child. You can't pick them up too much. You can't hold them. You can't hug them, because we want those connections to be the strongest. We want nurturing and love to be the strongest connection possible, because the more an experience happens, the stronger that connection gets. And so I want to go back to talk more about that slide, because, you know, I want to think about those two paths we talked about. You know, one common belief we hear in our society is that people whose experience takes them on that top path are dangerous, are maladaptive, and the people on the bottom path are adaptive. And we just want to say that's completely untrue. Both pathways are absolutely adaptive, and both brains are adapting to the environment and the experiences that they live in. And that's great for us as a species, because the people whose brains adapt to a dangerous or stressful world, they're more likely to survive when life is difficult and tough. And the people whose brains adapt to a safe world are likely to be prepared to meet society's expectations during tranquil times. So our experience really does get wired into our body. In this next slide, Dr. Teicher always says, is the problem becomes when our biology collides with social expectations that we really do run into trouble. So if you put a person in that bottom path, that benevolent world, into a really chaotic environment, let's say a riot or war, they may really struggle, and they're going to have to learn specific skills quickly because their body hasn't learned to survive in that chaotic world. Now I want you to think about how often we have children and families that we work with that are on that top path, and we're expecting them to instantaneously adapt to a more quiet world, right? So think about when a child comes to school and you want them to sit still, to share, to cooperate. This can be really difficult, and there can be a disconnect for this child. So they'll have to be actively taught the skills required to succeed in a context that we would train a person from the benevolent path, right, to be in a chaotic, we have to think about how do we help someone from more of that chaotic world now function in more of that benevolent setting. And, you know, we always say this, but this is why, again, instead of thinking about what's wrong with this child, we've got to think about what's happening. What's the environment like for this child? And how do we help them adapt to a much different setting? So I want to talk a little bit more about sort of factors that determine effects of maltreatment, because we're talking about the body's reaction. And one of the things we know is that age makes a difference. So why would the age of a person at the time of maltreatment have a powerful effect? And we're going to talk through that. And, you know, we saw all these great slides about the brain, and the brain really does tell that story, because the brain develops in a sequence, right? I said from the most primitive to the most advanced. So if you think about it, like I said before, a tiny baby doesn't need to be able to write a paper or pass a math test, but they do need to breathe and eat, regulate their body temperature and their sleep. And what I would say maybe most important, connect with someone who will nurture and protect them. So if the parts of the brain that control internal body functioning and the ability to connect to a primary caregiver develop earliest, we have to think about how does trauma along the lifespan impact that child differently if developmentally their body may be different at different times. So brain regions that control complex thought, you know, processes like abstract thinking and all of that develop later. So imagine on when that abuse occurs, important things are happening in the body. And this is this magnificent dance that we see of experience and also adaptation that generates these sort of age-appropriate capacities along the way. And these capacities are things like feeling and thinking and responding to the world around us. So as the brain develops, we see these sensitive periods for each brain region when the size and functional abilities of that region are most affected by experiences and are also most vulnerable to toxic stress. So new abilities build on the growth and development from the earlier ones. And so this is why setting that great brain architecture and building after that's so important. And that's why trauma could sort of derail this beautiful dance of building up that brain architecture. So over time, elaborate systems of specialized brain regions develop that help us navigate these increasingly complex environments as the child gets older. So toxic stress in early childhood, we know, has a profound effect on these brain structures that I'm talking about and the functions that develop later in childhood. And these functions include the mediation of emotional responses, social interaction, and of course, abstract thinking. And that's why people say that early childhood is so important. And they're absolutely right. So what happens early on makes a huge difference because of all of this early brain development. But I do always want to say at this point, you know, early childhood isn't the only sensitive developmental period, according to latest research. And I hope that reminds all of us, we can always have interventions that help. So getting there as early as possible is always wonderful. But at any given time, we can help support children and families and help their brain grow differently. But we do know the brain research has introduced that there's these sort of times that are more important. So for example, during middle childhood, what we know around ages like 7 to 13, emotional and verbal abuse can affect the centers for processing sound, developing verbal language, as well as perceiving social cues. And effects can actually be different for girls and boys. So for example, both neglect and sexual abuse affect boys and girls, but neglect in infancy and throughout the toddler years for boys has a larger effect on cross-brain communication, while cross-brain communication is profoundly affected in girls through sexual abuse of about ages 7 to 10. So you can see how there can be some gender differences as well as, of course, ages that these things impact the child differently. But by the time we reach our mid to late 20s, our central nervous system with the brain as its command center orchestrates everything from our automatic body functionings, things like breathing and heartbeat, to complex goal-oriented behavior, as well as abstract analytical thinking. And this elaborate signaling system in our brain is very well practiced by this age. In a fraction of a second, it can determine whether sensory information from sight, sound, touch, taste, smell should come into the brain or and be processed, or if it should be pushed out and filtered out to survive. And so stress may be interpreted by the brain as something we can tolerate and work through, or as something that's absolutely overwhelming and we can't deal with it at this point in time. And our set points for this interpretation of what we can take in and process and what needs to be pushed out is largely in place by early adulthood. And so we've talked a lot about these sensitive developmental periods when toxic stress really does have a profound effect on child development, human development. But these childhood times, I hope, makes all of us remember that these are huge windows of opportunity for building resilience. So if the developing brain is sensitive to all kinds of experience, we have the ability to promote these positive experiences that can grow the brain in the healthiest ways possible. So by paying attention to these really sensitive periods, we can do a better job protecting children and providing the kind of challenges and supports that they need to remediate these earlier periods of toxic stress and promote lifelong, healthy, and positive well-being of that child and family. So I love this slide. It says we have a collective choice. So we can actively develop skills and accommodations that enable everyone to contribute to community, or we can continue to sort of on this societal pattern of rejecting people when they just have normal adaptive responses to early adversity. So if you remember one thing from this information about brain development, I hope it will be that toxic stress can be hardwired into our biology. And so before we assume that a person's behaviors are a rebellious choice, let's think about the possibility that adversity may be at the heart of the challenges we see. And how do we lead with empathy and kindness for that chaotic world or path that they've been put on?
So far, we've been talking about the effects of toxic stress on individuals and individual bodies. Now we're going to switch gears and talk about the effects of toxic stress on our population as a whole. So we're going to turn to epidemiology, which is how the population as a whole is affected by a disease agent. And epidemiological research is not for diagnosis. We can't assume we know everything about an individual based on their epidemiological findings like those in the ACE study. Instead, the ACE study really helps us focus our efforts on issues and processes that'll make the most difference for the well-being of everyone. So we're going to talk about the Adverse Childhood Experiences study, often referred to as the ACE study. So until the 1990s, most studies centered on health and social effects of childhood abuse focused on a single type of adversity, such as sexual abuse. So the ACE study really broadened the picture to measure a wide array of social health and social problems. In fact, this is how the ACE study expanded the knowledge into a broader public health perspective. So the ACE study is really unique because it helps us understand how multiple forms of childhood stressors can affect many important public health problems. So before we go further, let's understand just a little bit more about the background. It did begin in 1991, and in 1994, the CDC provided the funding to conduct the ACE study with the Department of Preventive Medicine in San Diego. So they took, as Lana said, 17,000 adult members of the Kaiser Permanente health insurance plan, and they had them complete a really long survey. And in that survey, there were the questions about the adverse childhood experiences, but also they asked them about their health behaviors, their disease and risk of disease, as well as their mental health, substance abuse, and other health and social issues. Their ages ranged between the ages of 19 and 94. And the participants were generally well-educated and predominantly middle-class people who had access to really great healthcare in the world. So this slide shows the 10 categories of adverse childhood experiences. The group on the left of your screen indicates the household dysfunction. I call this group the things that might have happened around us. And so you can see the predominance of these experiences with this Kaiser Permanente group of individuals. 27% had grown up with substance abuse in the home, parental divorce, 23, and so forth. The middle section is neglect. And those are things that I say are things that did not happen to you. So you have emotional and physical neglect. And the far right are abuse, things that did happen to you, unfortunately, emotional, physical, or sexual abuse. And as you can see from the percentages on the slide, ACEs were really common in the study population. And I think it's really important to note that similar ACE surveys have been conducted thousands of times all over our country and all over the world. And the data is usually very similar to the original study's findings. In fact, the ACEs are so common, it's surprising and often kind of comes with a sense of disbelief if people have never heard about them before. Individuals who've experienced these ACEs might also feel relieved to know that they're really not alone in the world. But these findings really challenge us to face the reality that children in our culture are commonly exposed to chaotic family and living conditions. It takes courage to face these facts, but the hope comes from learning that changing the prevalence of ACEs is a great opportunity for preventing these health and social problems later in life. So because childhood experiences were so highly interrelated, it didn't make sense to look at a single category of ACE and how that influences social and health problems. Instead, Drs. Andes and Folletti developed the ACE score. And this score is simply a count of the number of categories of ACEs a person reports from 0 to 10. So each category counts as one ACE. So if a person experienced physical abuse, no matter how many times or how severe, that is an ACE score of 1. And if the person also experienced some sort of substance abusing parents, then the ACE score would be 2 and so forth. So you kind of think of the ACE score as a measure of childhood biological stress dose. Lana was talking about that stress dose happening in different critical periods of time in a child's life. And so this ACE score is just that stress dose. So the more ACEs a person has, the more exposure to that toxic stress Lana was discussing. So in this illustration, you also see that about a third of the population has an ACE score of 0. It's also noteworthy to see that 16% have 4 or more ACEs. So adverse childhood experiences are common, and they also tend to cluster. In fact, when there's one ACE in the life of a child, there's 87% chance that they will have one of the other 9 ACEs as well. So people who report higher ACE scores are more likely to have health and social problems. In fact, as that ACE score goes up, the percentage of people with health and social problems also goes up. So we call this a dose response relationship. So you can think of it, we often say, like driving a car, the more gas you put in the car, the further you can go. The more ACEs you have in life, the more likelihood you might have some sort of health or social problem. So in this case, where there's that high dose of ACE experience, there's a higher percentage of people with health problems. So what are some of these health problems that we're talking about that are on that vertical axis on the left? These are some of those examples. So when we look at this, these people these issues are things that were on that left axis. So for example, as ACEs increase, so does the prevalence of alcohol abuse. As ACEs increase, so does the prevalence of violence. And because ACEs have such a powerful impact on health and social problems, the ACE researchers really concluded that ACEs are the leading cause of health and social programs in our nation. Now that we know this, we have to use this knowledge to guide prevention. Dr. Robert Block of Oklahoma and the former president of the American Academy of Pediatrics is often quoted as saying, ACEs are the single greatest unaddressed public health threat facing our nation today. And he actually said that years ago. So right now we're really living in a time with stunning potential to shift the trajectory of these health problems and many others for generations to come. So how do we put all this together to make a case for understanding ACEs as a way to lead a path to health and well-being? Well, we know that ACEs are common and they have a strong cumulative impact on common health and social problems. Well, this is one of my favorite slides. It shows the percentage of various health and social problems that epidemiologists estimate are caused by ACEs. The calculation is commonly used to do this is called population attributable risk. And this is displayed as a percentage as an oil spill on this slide. So the percentage of a problem coded by the oil spill represent the percentage of each problem that is potentially preventable by preventing ACEs. So if we could prevent ACEs, it could reduce anxiety by, drinking and driving by about 45%. It could decrease smoking by 31%. And it could possibly decrease alcoholism by 65%. So the cumulative effect of ACEs reflect this powerful opportunity for prevention. No matter if you're working with heart disease or cancer, or you want to end homelessness or hopelessness, or even improve your business profitability, if we can align our work around a common goal of preventing the accumulation of ACEs and moderating their effect, we're going to reduce all these problems and many others all at once. So preventing ACEs and their intergenerational transmission is the greatest opportunity for improving this well-being of human population. ACEs are really common. They are highly interconnected. They have this cumulative impact. And people with high ACE scores are more likely to have multiple social and health problems, which increases the odds of their children having high ACE scores. So if you think about, if you have a parent that had an ACE score and now they are abusing alcohol and they are raising children in their home, now we begin to see the intergenerational transmission of ACEs. So we talked about the effect of toxic stress on the developing brain, and that help explains how toxic stress impacts our body and our health. That's what Lana talked about. So the impact of this stress on our body, and then you combine that with the ACE scores relationship to the health and problems, and this is what really supports the cause and effect relationship. So what about Oklahoma? What do ACE scores look like here? This is data pulled together from BRFSS, which is the Behavioral Risk Factor Surveillance System. I've just got a couple slides on this, but it's important information to look at. This is comparing the United States to Oklahoma. So zero ACEs, US has 38.5 and Oklahoma is 35, which actually we would want that number to be higher because we want less people to have zero ACEs. But if you jump down to four or more, you can see in the United States, it's about 16%. And in Oklahoma, it's 21%. So one or more ACEs, we have 65% of our population in Oklahoma, where in the general population of the United States, it's about 61. And this is a really interesting slide. It breaks it down into different regions within Oklahoma. And these are people reporting four or more ACEs. So when we start talking about self-healing communities and doing community work, it's really important to look down and factor into different counties and regions and where do we maybe need to focus some more supports or resources to really help prevent ACEs. So the data about childhood adversities can seem really daunting unless we remember what Dr. Anda emphasized. If it's predictable, it's preventable. And Linda will now explain how we can work together to help decrease ACEs.
Thank you, Cheryl. Now we're going to talk about how we can apply this knowledge about the ACE study toward fostering resilience in individuals and in communities. Our culture tends to separate the way we think about and address health and social problems. We refer to this way of doing business in society as a siloed approach. Each silo tends to have its own budget, training, and mental model for prevention and treatment of the individual types of problems that fall within its area of focus. The ACE study and the knowledge about the effects of ACEs on brain structure and function now show us that viewing health and social problems as separate issues is a misconception based on outdated mental models. Now we know that many common health and social problems also share a common cause based on the powerful impact that ACEs have throughout the life course. Ideally, we should want to try and break down these silos, but we know that that's not really practical because budgets and priorities are in these siloed systems are too well defended, as is our human nature and organizational behavior. But the good news is that none of us has to stop working on the issues that we are passionate about. If we simply add a thread to our work, that is focused on preventing the accumulation of ACEs, that common thread will connect and align all of our work in powerful ways. The ACE study provides us with straightforward information about the consequences of toxic stress during childhood. Cheryl went through that for us. This scientific research gives us powerful information that we can use every day to improve health, safety, well-being, and longevity. But the ACE study isn't a detailed roadmap of services and programs. It is, however, an open invitation for us to be pioneers. This news is simply too important to wait for someone else to design a detailed roadmap. Through our collective knowledge and actions, we are the ones with the power to change the dynamics within our own families, communities, and society that tend to lead to high ACE scores. When we begin talking about the findings of the ACE study, those conversations often lead us to talk about resilience. People get excited about the notion of resilience, in part because it reminds us that our supportive actions matter and can lead to powerful change. Our desire for resilience leads us naturally to search for ways to help families and communities. Let's look at three protective systems that interact and guide positive adaptation. These powerful systems are attachment and belonging with caring and competent people, building individual capabilities, and protective community, faith, and cultural practices. What do we know about individuals who do well despite adversity? We know that these three protective systems are nested. People do best when they are living and in thriving families and communities. We can assist one another in developing the personal attributes that help us all weather life's storms. Personal attributes like positive view of one's life, self-efficacy, and self-regulation are all discussed at length in the resilience literature. The first protective system we can nurture is attachment and belonging. We all know about the importance of having people in our lives, people who recognize and encourage our unique talents, interests, and strengths. Relationships with caring and competent people are vital contributors to resilience and recovery. Sometimes this message gets shortened and only includes caring relationships, but competency requires learning new skills and practicing safety in all of its forms, especially when relating to people who are hardwired for survival in a dangerous and unpredictable world, as we learned about in Lana's portion of the presentation. People who have difficulty with emotional regulation, picking up on social cues, problems with addiction and family bonds, and other consequences of developmental trauma can be challenging to friends and neighbors. Relationships that provide security and belonging will become the norm as we learn and improve our skills and competencies to be relevant and helpful during times of stress and challenge, as well as during times of celebration and rest. The second protective system is helping to build individual capabilities. Positive view lets me know that I'm important and valuable. It empowers me to ask for help when I need it. Positive view is closely related to hope, and together they help me not give up. Positive view is also about the story we tell ourselves that good things happen to me. When we recognize the core gifts of each person and help them find opportunities to give those gifts to a community they care about, we are helping to generate positive view and hope. People with positive view, hope, and social emotional support are more likely to complete at least 1 year of post-high school education, more likely to be employed, and less likely to be depressed. Self-efficacy is the belief that what I do influences what happens to me. Simple things can help build self-efficacy in others, like asking people to do tasks or chores that have real value for the family or community, and encouraging a person to build skills that are complex and take time to develop. Self-regulation is our ability to gauge our own emotions and state of mind, and to keep these under control while we navigate a given social situation. When we can't or don't read the situation and adapt our behavior to it, the social aspects of life become more difficult. There are a number of strategies for practicing self-regulation. Depending upon the cultural environment, these might include belly breathing, mindfulness, prayer, movement, biofeedback, and other calming practices. While there certainly are individual capabilities that are associated with recovery and resilience, these are often the very same capabilities that do not develop well when experiencing toxic stress. Believing that people could and should try harder to be what their biologic adaptations keep them from being is the circular logic that just simply is not helpful. If we've decided to dramatically improve health and safety for this and future generations, we must foster thriving communities. Fostering thriving communities is about empowerment. It's about investing in the people who have the most at stake so they can be the expert leaders of their own community's change. As we invest in community capacity, we can systematically provide education about neurobiology, ACEs, and resilience so that everyone at the local level has a common language for cross-sector and multidisciplinary work. Building community capacity is about helping people learn, manage, and improve their efforts in a systematic way, and about providing flexible funding, state-of-the-art education, and direct supports that help mobilize everyone who wants to help. Public and private partners who foster thriving communities can learn from those communities and celebrate the exceptional results from their work. To learn more about capacity building processes, we can look and learn from other communities that have changed the way people work together to solve problems and have had stunning success. Success doesn't happen overnight. It's a journey that intentionally builds new capacities and supports healing and prevention. What does leadership expansion really mean? High capacity communities consider everyone who wants to help as a leader and open opportunities for people to contribute their gifts and talents to commonly held goals. Leadership must include the voice of lived experience and conversations. We must remember the saying, "Don't do anything for me without me." We need to empower all people to have a voice. Diverse perspectives enrich our solutions and enhance the resources available for community improvement. Even something as simple as offering thoughts about how to keep children safe and healthy is an important form of leadership that fuels capacity. The second phase of the capacity development process is coming together around issues that matter. People have an instinctive need to be together. And when we are together, we can find one another's strengths and act upon them. Conversations that matter to community members build social networks. That's an important factor for building resilience. Conversations, sharing perspectives, looking at data are all activities that help us gain a common knowledge and view of how our neighbors and other members of our community are faring in their lives. When we do come together and discuss difficult issues, like adverse childhood experiences, strong emotions of grief, longing, and hope may arise. So it is especially important for us as community leaders to build in supports that create a sense of safety for everyone. The third phase of the capacity development process is shared learning, exactly what we are doing here today. It's especially valuable for us to develop a common language and understanding around an issue like the language and concepts of adverse childhood experiences. Learning together naturally leads to people sharing and generating opportunities to help one another and potentially combine resources to achieve commonly held goals. Something as simple as one person needing a book in order to complete a class and another person lending that book can be an important capacity building opportunity. Larger exchanges take place in community capacity development, but the small exchanges establish the norm of offering help. When we share perspectives, cultural differences, common values, and simple interest in one another, we naturally build hope and a sense of shared identity and belonging. It becomes easier for us to ask for and receive help. It becomes easier for us to notice how we can help others. Families become more stable when there is reciprocity, that give and flow of interaction that benefits all of us. In high capacity communities, emotional support, practical help, and assurances of safety are given and received in the flow of community life. If we learn and remember anything from this presentation, it is that ACEs are not destiny. People whose lives are impacted by childhood adversity are becoming leaders of self-healing communities, and they are working hard to help decrease the occurrence of future ACEs. So what are some of the things that we can all do to help? In Washington, state officials added questions about resilience factors to a telephone survey of adults. Cheryl mentioned the BRFAS survey. These questions form four resilience factors that make a difference. The first, feeling lonely, feeling socially and emotionally supported and hopeful. This is about how I feel internally about my life. Second, having people who will physically show up and help if I call and or text for help. No, that doesn't mean showing up on Facebook. That means you've got to be willing to come in person to help. Three, being willing to count on other adults in a variety of ways. This is about reciprocity, how adults in a community or neighborhood pitch in to help and be helped and look out for one another's families. And the fourth factor is the hardest kind of social capital to build. It's written about extensively in the disaster preparedness literature. It's called social bridging. When communities have high levels of social bridging, they are better able to recover after a natural disaster. So what is social bridging? Think of a circle of people that you count on for help and support. How common is it for one of you to reach outside of your circle to someone you don't know well to bring into your circle? And how common is it to reach outside your circle to give help? This reaching across our normal social groups is social bridging. It's important for people to feel supported both socially and emotionally to help them feel hopeful. To be able to better weather life storms, we want them to feel that way always or usually, and not rarely or never. There's a predictable pattern to transformational change. It begins with discovery and communication, which leads people to clarify their values and their thinking. And with new knowledge and new ways of thinking, people can change the actions they take in everyday life. The collective actions of a group of people can and will shape a new reality that leads to organizational and policy change. The fact is that people create a new reality long before new laws are passed. So change is up to us. It's shaped by our thoughts, our conversations, and by the way we relate with one another in our relationships, in our families, and in our communities. The Near Science Beyond ACEs training is supported by the Potts Family Foundation with additional funding awarded through a grant from Blue Cross Blue Shield Healthy Kids, Healthy Families Program. And as Joe mentioned, funding through OICA to help sponsor the three-day training. We now have 30 professionals across Oklahoma trained by Laura Porter and Dr. Rob Anda to present this information and train future facilitators across the state. The purpose of our team of community resilience trainers is to spread the awareness and understanding of the science behind trauma and its impact on the brain in order to spark people and communities to put interventions and prevention practices into place that increase the ability for individuals, families, and communities to thrive. The Potts Family Foundation also supports and coordinates Oklahoma's Self-Healing Communities Network. These communities are using a cross-sector approach to build common understanding, vocabulary, and approach to resilience building through the ACE interface Self-Healing Communities framework.
We meet monthly virtually to share information and resources to help support and build this momentum in our state. Please contact us if you would like more information. The foundation also manages the virtual community Raising Resilient Oklahomans on pacesconnection.com to share information and resources from research and initiatives around the globe that foster trauma-informed communities and resilience. You're encouraged to join this virtual community using the link on the slide, and we will also put it in the chat. And now we ask that you please take a few minutes to give us your feedback, both on the presenters as well as on the presentation, as we continue to refine our efforts, and your feedback is important to help us do that. Please note that if you use the hyperlink, it must be in all caps to work, as it's printed there on the slide. You can also use the QR code with your cell phone's camera or scanning app. And it looks like we might have time to take two or a couple of minutes to do that, if you would. And then we'll finish up with the last slide. Well, hopefully you've at least been able to pull up the survey and can finish it at some point today and get that sent in. We do appreciate it, as I said. And so as we work together to prevent the accumulation of ACEs, keep in mind that we don't have to get to ACE scores of zero. If our efforts can help bring ACE scores down any amount, as Cheryl mentioned, it will have huge effects. We might not be able to prevent a first ACE from occurring in a family, but we can certainly notice when children have five ACEs and make sure that number does not go higher. As we thread all of our work through a new focus on supporting adults, particularly adults who through no fault of their own, experienced many ACEs when they were children, we will prevent ACEs for the next generation. We live at a time of great hope and promise. The largest public health discovery of our time, and perhaps of all time, is about family, community, and children. It's about us. Our actions to prevent ACEs, whether large or small, can and will profoundly improve our future. Joe, thanks again to OICA and the Fall Forum for letting us be a part of this. We'd be happy, if there's any time left and any questions, to address those. If not, we look forward to our partners in this work and Dr. Hayes Grudeau talking about the protective factors in more in depth.
Linda, Lana, Cheryl, thank you so much. That was fantastic. We do have a few minutes left, and if no one has questions, we will kick it over to Jennifer, but feel free to type your questions over here in the chat. It's good to know that there's so much that's happening out there to help overcome what we're experiencing in Oklahoma with the numbers that we face in our state with the trauma. And I know Jennifer really is one of those that got me very interested in this in my first month at OICA, just seeing the stark reality of what we face here with the trauma through the years and the generational issues. And to know each of you is working in this area to try and see improvements. I know we're going to see improvement. I'm just optimistic things are going to get better.
Agree.
Well, Jennifer, do you want to go ahead and kick things off? We'll let you get started a few minutes early if you want.
We'd be happy to. My colleague Amanda Morris is also on. So if I can share the screen, we're going to do this together.
Can you hear me? I'm not sure why my video isn't working. Let me just.
We definitely can hear you.
Okay.
But you can hear you, Amanda. So we'll introduce ourselves briefly. I know many of you, and I'm happy to see your faces or your names on my screen. I'm Jennifer Hayes Grudo. I am now at OSU Center for Health Sciences, where I've been since 2018. Before that, I was 5 years in Stillwater at OSU, the mothership that we like to call her sometimes, in the Department of Human Development and Family Science. And before that, I was at OU Tulsa doing research with the George Kaiser Family Foundation and Educare on how to help children who are growing up in adverse circumstances. So then I moved to OSU, and I like to say we're not football players. We can collaborate. We're not enemies. We're too small to compete. And my colleague, Amanda Morris, I'll let her introduce herself. Are you there still, Amanda? We're in two different places, so the miracle of technology sometimes is also the frustration of technology. I'll briefly introduce Amanda. Amanda's been at OSU Tulsa since she relocated from the University of New Orleans after Katrina. And so she is a Regents professor also. She's the George Kaiser Family Foundation chair of, I think it's now called Psychology and Developmental Neuroscience. And we're going to describe what we have learned working both separately and then together for the past 7 or 8 years, and do it in the context of what does it mean for you? I loved hearing Linda say that ACEs is not destiny, because it's really important. ACEs can change the course of your life, but it doesn't necessarily cause your life to irreversibly go in a terrible direction. And as developmental scientists, Amanda and I were really aware when we first became familiar with ACEs about 10 years ago that there was a whole lot of developmental research that hadn't been covered in the ACEs conversation at that point. And that had to do with resilience and the protective factors that promote resilience. Some of you might know the name. There's Amanda. I see her face now. Now, maybe familiar with the name Ann Maston. She wrote one of the definitive books on resilience called Ordinary Magic. And Amanda had a conversation one day when Ann was in Tulsa giving a talk, and Amanda was telling her about ACEs and how the conversations at conferences sometimes missed all this developmental research on protective factors. And Ann said, so you know what they are, come up with a measure. And so we did, and we've been doing research on that since about what, 2013, 2014. And yeah. So we're gonna share that with you today. I just wanna share this first hour, our graphic, because it's hokey for a reason. It's the heart represents to us the protective factors. You just heard Linda talk about all the importance of relationships that matter to counteract the effects of ACEs. It turns out there are more things besides relationships that we've identified from the research and from others and from our own, but it works like a buffer. It surrounds children, and instead of leading towards terrible events, it can lead toward recovery, resilience, and post-traumatic growth, and the ability to help other people. We summarized all of this in a book that came out last year, published by the American Psychological Association, which was titled Adverse and Protective Childhood Experiences, because ACEs is half of the story. Protective and compensatory experiences is the other half. And if any of you have watched the resilience film as it's been presented by the Potts Family Foundation. I know they're always careful when they give a group the ACEs questionnaire to fill out. There's almost always, or always, the PACES questionnaire on the back, because that's the other side of it. So we're going to talk about how PACES can be applied in our everyday lives and in our agencies and in our work, in our own lives, and a little bit about some future steps that we're taking to take this to the next level. So I think I went the wrong way. Hang on. Amanda.
Can you hear and see me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm sorry. We do Zoom all the time. Then for some reason, right when you have a talk, it doesn't work. But the PACES really did come from our work and also from the developmental literature. And we have been talking about these since 2015. And they really can be broken down into two categories, relationships and resources. And we'll go through each one of these briefly, but it's important that when we talk about these protective and compensatory experiences, to understand that these are modifiable things. These are not traits. These are not characteristics. We are talking here about protective factors. And so the relationship side, we have thinking about relationships with peers and friends, also with caregivers, the resources, these enriched environments, being part of a group. An important thing to understand when we're talking about PACES too, is that these are just like ACEs, anything that the experience that occurred before age 18. So you'll see a little further on in our presentation today that the PACES really can be thought of a little bit differently depending on the age of the child. So in general, these PACES, these protective factors, work at any age. And we'll talk a little bit about adult PACES as well, but they look a little bit different depending on the age of the child. So the relationship part, these are certainly, there is, I think, an order to these. And the first one that's most important is unconditional love from a caregiver. And so we talk about that, and you can think about it from a research perspective, this warm and sensitive, consistent parenting, securely attached children, children who live in a consistent world where they know that their needs are met. So this unconditional love is really the foundation of the PACES. Having a best friend, this looks a little bit different when kids are younger, but having a good friend that you can go to, who you can count on, the research has shown that this has been protective in a variety of settings. And we want to make sure that kids have these opportunities. Often when we're talking about ACEs, it's a parent that's actually the perpetrator of an ACE. So having someone outside of the family, a mentor, someone who has your back, it can be a coach, it can be a teacher. These are also PACEs and have been shown in the literature to be important protective factors. Being part of a group, that sense of belonging, it's really important, particularly as children grow older, and it helps to explore their identity. It can be a club, it can be a group. And then volunteering, especially if it's done with a parent, really helps children to understand and get outside of their own environment and get a broader sense of the world. And it allows them to be able to accept help when they need it. Again, a strong research in this area as well. Jennifer's doing the slides for me.
I am, and I was trying to unmute myself because I'm gonna talk about resources. This is something I feel really strongly about. One of our colleagues who does research on resilience in Canada is named Michael Unger, and he likes to say, no one is resilient alone. So it's not just the relationships, but it's the people in the community who advocate for children and make sure those environments are there that provide them the resources they need to grow up well. You've probably heard many people talk about how what helped them recover from a terrible childhood was the ability they had to play some sport or be physically active in a way that might have gotten them a scholarship, but it probably also got them in touch with a coach who cared about them and with teammates whose homes they could stay at when things were bad at their house. We just know from the literature that being able to be physically active, whether individually or in a social, team sport, is helpful. Having a hobby is something we don't often think about as being a protective factor, but for children at all ages, children need to feel mastery, that they're good at something. It gives them positive self-worth, positive self-esteem, in contrast to what ACEs often teach children, that they're not worthwhile, that they're not worthy of being treated well or expecting good things to happen to them. So having opportunities for hobbies, I remember when back in the dark ages, when I was in elementary school, anybody could play in the school orchestra and just basically go check out a violin or a cello or in the band or get a flute on loan. And a lot of those programs have disappeared, both because taxes have risen to cover other things and because we're often not as confident about the importance of these activities as we are about passing test scores. And these activities are really important, and I fear they're disappearing from the very schools that where they're needed the most. It's important to recognize that even in a home where there is dysfunction and abuse and neglect, there's some basic needs that need to be met that parents can still provide regardless of what else is happening. They need to have a clean home, a home that's childproof from accidents and accidental injuries, and certainly have enough food to eat. Those things go a long way. Think about Maslow's hierarchy. You can't achieve your potential if you're hungry. And clean homes and uncluttered homes take away a source of stress from children. So that's important. Having clear and fair rules with predictable routines is a source of safety and comfort. Those of you in education know the importance of routines. This is what we do in the morning. This is what we do at lunchtime. This is what we do at dinner time and at bedtime. So those are important paces. And then finally, going to a good school. This is just huge. We know that starting with early childhood education, there's a 7-to-1 return at least for every dollar invested in early Head Start and Head Start. As children grow up, being able to go to good schools helps them, again, develop those skills and qualities that will help them be able to function in the adult world and continue to recover from ACEs. So basically, we have done PACES research. Amanda, you want to talk about what our most recent paper showed?
Sure. So we have collected data on the PACES from a number of people. And overall, we find that the measure does respond the way that we think it should. So it's what we would call reliable and valid, and that parents who report more ACEs are also reporting fewer PACEs and vice versa. We're also finding that PACE scores are related to less depression in adulthood, higher education, and more income. But importantly, and we recently published a paper on this, PACEs do act as a protective factor against hostile attitudes toward parenting. And so these are parents who are reporting, their different attitudes on parenting. And in particular, when they have more of a hostile attitude toward parenting, that is the case when ACEs are high, but not when PACEs are high. So we think of PACEs as not only important during childhood, but how those PACEs during childhood are predicting parenting attitudes and parenting behavior in adulthood.
And that's obviously important because that's helping to break the cycle of ACEs. When parents who have had ACEs themselves, but also had high PACE scores and are now less distinctive, as you can't really tell the difference sometimes in their parenting attitudes and self-reported behaviors than parents who did not have ACEs. So we think, that this is a good time to pause for a minute and let you just do a little screen for yourself. I know we've all been encouraged to know our ACE score, but again, I think that's only half the story. The other half of the story is what good happened in your childhood. Who are you grateful for? What are you grateful for? Because as you look back on it, you realize, oh, thank goodness I had that person in my life, or that school, or that opportunity. So just take about 1 minute and read through each of these. I'm not going to read them for you because I hate it when people read to me, and I can read better and faster myself. And then we'll talk about this at the end, what insights we might get from our own paces. So I'm going to be quiet for a minute. Okay, if you want to just jot down any numbers or thoughts that you had as you were doing that, we're going to come back to this a little bit later. But I will say that one of the first times I gave the paces to someone, they were so relieved to recognize that their childhood hadn't been a total desert. It hadn't been awful in every respect, and that they didn't have to walk around feeling like they were broken. We're going to talk now about how we can use PACES in therapeutic contexts, whether it's in a clinical setting or in an educational setting. We have been using PACES, for example, in several settings where people are working on overcoming the effects of adversity and trauma in their childhood. And we think there are lots of good ways to do it. We talk about those also in our book, the cognitive behavioral therapy, particularly if it's trauma-informed, mindfulness work, yoga, other things like expressive writing, even drama therapy. There are a lot of things that can help people recover as adults from ACEs. But if you are getting the insights and the recovery through therapy and other help, it doesn't necessarily mean you have the blueprint for how to create a healthy home, a healthy set of routines and habits. And so that's where PACES comes in, and we've created PACES plans. So basically it's taking each of the PACES, describing them as they are for adults. What do they look like for adults, rather than the questionnaire that's developed for children? For example, for love, knowing that you're loved and that you love someone else unconditionally, you don't care that you're cared for. If this is something you don't have in your life, this is obviously something we think you should take steps to try to increase. The one of the PACES that we didn't include, because there just wasn't enough data yet, but the data is coming along, is pets. Amanda and I had this conversation now for 7-8 years, and I'm a firm believer that if you don't have someone, you move to a new town and you don't know anybody else, adopt a pet, adopt a dog, adopt a cat, find someone whose tail wags, it's the equivalent, whose eyes light up when you walk in the room. So what we encourage people to do is to take one pace at a time, 1 month at a time, and then work through each pace. By the end of a year, your life will look different. This can be done for adults, and it can be done for children. I don't know if you want to say anything specific about this plan, Amanda, which we developed for children really little kids, babies, infants, and toddlers.
Yeah, again, I just want to mention that this is being done at the Tulsa EduCares. We've had several workshops, and one of our colleagues, Ruth Slocum, is doing the PACES plan there with the staff. And again, I think it's interesting to think about how these PACES work at different ages, but the concepts really are universal. And so we have some specifics here about how parents and caregivers can work on a PACES plan for their children. And the other thing Jennifer and I had talked about when we first presented these was, it's like a magnet on your refrigerator. What do I need to be doing for my kids? And it's also one of those things when you're running around and taking them to these activities and things, remembering that there is research that this these PACES and these activities that your kids are doing really are important. And so it is worth your time. So I don't know, it's kind of small on my screen, but hopefully you can see that. And then we also have, we'll show you later, we have a website where you can get a lot of this information too.
Yeah, and I just want to point out that keeping these PACES in mind for children is also a way to remind yourself you aren't responsible for providing every PACE for your child. Your job as a parent is to help find the resources in the community and connect with other people and other programs where your kids can take advantage of opportunities for resources and to build other relationships. Because sometimes it feels overwhelming, like, oh my gosh, this is too much. I can't do all this by myself. And that's true. We need help.
Yeah. And one other thing that I think is really important when you're talking about developing PACES for children is that it's really essential that parents have their own foundation and that parents are caring for themselves, because it's really hard, as everyone in this group knows, to care for others when you're not caring for yourself. And so we really encourage parents to think about their own life history, what they're doing now, and how their life history is affecting their parenting, because especially things like emotion regulation and coping and keeping yourself healthy, all of those things, once they're in place, will really help to develop the PACES and to deal with children, help children who are facing ACEs and overcoming ACEs. So again, I think it's important to think about these together. So it's not just about the child or the parent, it's really both.
So Amanda mentioned we have been working with EduCare. I forgot to put that on this slide, but we've done some other things as well. You want to talk about the extension service?
Sure. So previously I was a cooperative extension educator and worked with cooperative extension through OSU. And we have been doing a number of fact sheets specifically on ACEs and on PACEs that can be downloaded and given out. They're written in very plain language, so they're easy to understand. We have ACEs and PACEs, particularly the PACEs for the different ages. And then we'll talk a little bit about it more later, but we did develop some specific fact sheets around PACEs during COVID. So how to think about this during times of adversity and stress, in particular the pandemic.
We're also doing a program now with the Department of Health, Oklahoma Department of Health, which is not just PACEs, but it's also incorporating mindfulness training into the first responders activities to prevent them from having the burden of trauma that they take home with them after dealing with crisis situations and people whose lives are in trouble. We've also talked, this is a brand new initiative, but I'm very excited about it. So I put it in here, even though we don't have anything signed yet. We've been talking with folks at Chickasaw Nation about looking at PACEs from a First American perspective, from a Native American perspective. Are there unique or different protective and compensatory experiences that folks whose ancestors have experienced trauma, who have that legacy of historical trauma, that have helped them be resilient and survive and thrive in the face of some truly horrific experiences in the past? And then we have just launched a new project, which we want to share with you because it's important for Oklahoma. It's important for the nation, and we're really proud to be one of the sites to be awarded the Healthy Brain and Child Development site. Oops, Amanda.
Sure. So several years ago, we were part of a planning grant through the National Institutes of Health for a study of baby brain development. And we had 2 years to really plan a larger study that would be conducted across the United States on factors that affect healthy brain development. And the idea was to start recruitment prenatally and then follow the babies over 10 years. We recently found out in September that we were chosen for the larger study. So we were part of the planning grant, and then the larger study chose 25 sites across the country, and OSU is a site. And what's exciting about this is this will be one of the first studies to actually look longitudinally at brain development in the same babies for 10 years. There is an adolescent study that started when the kids were 9 and 10, and this will be the first part of the study, the Healthy Brain Child Development Study. We're not only looking at brain development, we will have MRIs on the babies. You have to get the MRIs when babies are asleep because they have to be still. So we've been practicing that and working on that at OSU in our new imaging center at Hardesty Biomedical Imaging, which is actually on Riverside. But we'll do MRIs in the first 6 weeks of life, and then we'll do it subsequently every year. So we'll have the structural and functional brain development of the babies. We'll be getting biospecimens on the mothers and the babies. So we'll be able to look at cortisol and stress hormones. We also get EEG on the babies and the little EEG caps. So especially when the babies are between 1 and 4, it's really hard to get them in the scanner and for them to be still. So the EEG will give us different kind of information about brain development. And we're really excited because our site was chosen for a couple of main reasons. We will be recruiting, and we will have a number of Native Americans in our sample. So we're expecting based on the sample characteristics of Tulsa, Circa, and our research and our history here on studying adversity and resilience made a really important contribution to our application as well. And then also we have the National Center for Wellness and Recovery. So a portion of the sample will be recruited for adversity. And so there will be a portion of moms who have used substances during pregnancy. We will be targeting low-income families. So we're going to have a range of individuals and families in the study. So we'll be able to really look at adverse and protective experiences. We have a great team here at OSU. You can see that here. Jennifer and Julie Croft and I are all working on this together. We have neuroimagers. We have Lana Beasley, who I think was on the call earlier. We have individuals who have expertise in infancy and in EEG. We have a great team across the university. And then I think it's just really cool to look at where we are. So OSU was chosen as a site amongst universities like Harvard and Northwestern and Johns Hopkins and University of California, San Diego, University of Pennsylvania. So we're really proud to sort of be that middle part of the country and to represent Oklahoma here. I think it's really important to have diversity among the sites. And you can see here the 25 sites that are going to be part of the 10-year study.
So I'm going to pick it up now and transition to talking about another thing we are looking at as part of HBCD, aside from the kinds of adversity we've talked about today, is the effects of COVID. You can't start a brand new study to launch in 2021, recruit people who've just gone through what we've all gone through with COVID. And so over the course of the last year, we've asked ourselves, and we've even looked at data, how is COVID affecting our kids? Some of you may have seen the headlines. A paper was published in the Journal of Pediatrics a week or two ago saying that at least 140,000 children have lost a parent, at least one parent, or a caregiving grandparent to COVID. during the first year and a half of the pandemic. And those numbers are climbing, and climbing actually more rapidly right now, because the Delta variant tends to attack younger people and have a higher mortality rate in younger people, not the over 70s that we saw in the first wave of the pandemic, but more folks in their 30s, 40s, and 50s who also have children. This is a devastating thing for children who lose a parent. It's for life. And unless we have policies that address what these kids need, they're going to be suffering other ACEs. We know that children who end up in out-of-care home, in out-of-care placements, are more likely to be abused or neglected than children who stay at home and get help through relatives. And also, the pandemic has affected millions of children on their school experience and on their ability to learn. Again, it disproportionately affects children who've already experienced diversity or who are in marginalized populations, low income, minority, and ethnic minority populations. It has an effect on their social emotional development. I mean, when children, very young children, grow up where being close to people is dangerous, and they see somebody walking down the street towards them and they say, oh no, it's a person. That's something we don't really know yet, how that's going to affect people, given that PACES relies on having people connect, having children connect with adults. The other positive thing, if I can say there is a positive thing out of this horrific experience that the world has gone through, it has made us more sensitive in some respects, that adversity affects all of us. It's in a way, it's no respecter of persons. The virus attacks wealthy and poor. We can shield ourselves and we can provide more protection, but we're all at risk, and our children are all at risk. And so it's a reminder of the importance of helping children develop that reservoir of resilience through having more protective experiences around them. And in particular, during the pandemic and during its many manifestations, we have talked about how PACES can help buffer the effects on our children. Amanda and I have been interviewed by people around the world, in fact, on how PACES can affect, be helpful in buffering the effects. I want to point out a study that was done at our institute at CIRCA, the Center for Research, Integrative Research on Childhood Adversity. And this was done by Karina Schreffler, who was at OSU until July 1st. She's now at OU School of Nursing. I told you we collaborate. We go back and forth. And in this study, she started in 2017. She recruited low-income, high-risk pregnant women from our OU and OSU clinics and has been following them over the course of the last 3 years. So she had these data to look at both the biological effects of their childhood adversity and on their behavioral effects, and how that would impact their offspring, their pregnancy, the childbirth, and then the offspring themselves. So looking at these data, she was able to look then, she had data before, during, and we hoped it was after, but it turned out it really wasn't after because we had some other waves. But I want to show you what we saw. We just published these findings earlier this year. In this graph, you can see low ACEs are the blue bars and high ACEs are the yellow bars. And the first set of bars is before COVID depression scores. And you see, not surprisingly, that the depression is worse for those who've experienced ACEs or the high ACEs group. But you see COVID, during COVID, the depression scores for everyone went up. So again, COVID is affecting everyone, but it is higher, continues to be higher for those with ACEs. The same thing for perceived stress before and during the pandemic. So wherever your baseline was, you went up during the pandemic. And that's important to know because it means many of us feel stressed, but those of us who've had high ACEs are going to feel a lot more stress and deal with more issues of depression.
And to piggyback on that a little bit, I'm the editor of the Journal of Research on Adolescence, and it's an international journal. And we really wanted to do a call and have a special issue that looked particularly at adolescence, because we know that teenagers were really struggling during the pandemic. It's not normal for a teenager to be locked in their home with their parents and not able to see their peers. And we did a call to get papers from across the world. And we really focused on, again, it's really important to think about data, like Jennifer was presenting, that before and during the pandemic. So you can look at change. And you can look at what was going on prior to the pandemic and how that related to the pandemic. And we recently published this. There's a link there to the special issue, but we have 25 articles that are representing four different continents around the world. And these are all adolescent samples. And there's just a summary here of some of the main things that we found. But similar to what Jennifer was saying, that overall we saw emotion regulation and depressive symptoms increase, but this was worse for adolescents who had problems prior to the pandemic. And it was definitely related to the amount of COVID stress. And so adolescents whose parents were losing their job, whose family members got sick, they had much more negative effects of COVID and much more mental health problems because of COVID. So the amount of COVID stress really did play a role. We also, in this special issue, talked about some things that we can learn and do in the future. And so when we're thinking about mental health, screening for mental health problems prior to the pandemic really seems to be important. We saw a lot around depression, also self-harm. Adolescents who had engaged in cutting or self-harm behaviors prior to the pandemic were more likely to do so during the pandemic. Also, the interventions that are focused on emotion regulation and coping seem to be very promising because those are targeted areas where we think we could see a difference in the future. And I think it's important to note that we did see many youth doing well. And so despite the pandemic, we saw a lot of resilience. And this was strongly linked to families, to positive family relationships, to positive emotions within the family, and peer relationships. Even if they were maintaining their peer relationships through screens and not seeing them in person, this still played a protective role. In addition to the depression, a lot of loneliness was reported during adolescence. And, you know, this paper came out, all of these papers came out in September, and we're still seeing the effects of the pandemic on adolescents. And I think it's going to be, Jennifer and I have talked, that this is going to be a period that will define this generation. And I think when we look developmentally over time, we'll be talking about the effects of the pandemic for quite some time and how they affected development and different developmental trajectories. So this is just sort of a snapshot of what's going on now. But I think this kind of work is really important as we talk about development in the future. This slide, I hopefully you can see it. It's a little small on my screen. But Jennifer and I also published an article in The Conversation, which is a more popular press type of article. And we talked about applying PACEs to the pandemic. And we did this for different ages. And so these are specifically COVID-related, pandemic-related suggestions based on PACEs at different ages. And so what that might look like. And with young children, again, a lot of this is in the parents' control. They are controlling who and what their kids are seeing and doing. And you have to think about how to do all these different things safely. So we talk in there quite a bit about like how to do screen time with different groups or with grandparents. As kids get older, so if you think about teens and young adults, it's a lot more about having conversations about how to be safe, checking in with them, making sure that those foundations are in place, but there's less control. And so you can see that reflected in these specific recommendations.
Just to pick up on that, we didn't plan this, but the next slide really talks about conversations. This is something I think you will have heard Cheryl and Linda also talk about, how the first step in helping a person, a parent, a child, a community recover from adversity, from traumatic trauma, creating events, is talking about it. And ACEs and PACEs conversations are important because it helps us be the author of our life story, to create our own narrative where we are the hero. We're not the victims. We're the people who, geez, we had this set of adversities, but then we recovered. I've recently gotten interested in fairy tales. Amanda's not quite there yet. We have our own conversations about the importance of different things for the books that we write and the research we do. But if you think about it, for thousands of years, parents have told their children stories about the big bad wolf, because we know, and children know deep in their bones, in their genetic memory, there are dangers out there. And what every big myth, whether it's the Odyssey or Little Red Riding Hood, in every story, there is some kind of event, some kind of traumatic experience that the hero has to find both the internal and the external resources to marshal together, to develop the courage, the strength, the wisdom to get home safely, or to get to a new home that will allow them to continue to survive and thrive. So this importance of storytelling, I think, is really important. And it starts by knowing what were our ACEs. Maybe they're the 10 that are on there. Maybe they're different ones. Amanda and I had a chance to have dinner one night with Bessel van der Kolk after a 0-3 presentation he gave. And he told us he has an ACE score of 0. But he said, that doesn't mean I didn't have trauma. I had a lot of trauma. He was born in Holland during the winter that the German army imposed a blockade, and Dutch adults lost on average 25% of their body weight. They almost starved to death as a people. That was his childhood, his earliest childhood. And so there are lots of things that could have caused adversity in our lives. The first step is to talk about it with the supportive people, create alternative coping and life strategies. We think that's where PACES comes in, with hope, meaning, and purpose, and rewrite these stories, whether it's for ourselves or to help others who are in that process. We know we don't do it alone. All of you have probably seen this slide, if it was presented earlier, I apologize. But I think it's really important to create the soil, to create the ground, the community that's going to help yield fruit that's positive, that's virtuous, as opposed to fruit that's harmful and unhelpful. And with that is our summary. We wanted to go back and remind people there are lots of resources out there, aside from the ones that have been discussed with the self-healing communities that the Potts Family Foundation and others are providing to individual communities. There are books, there are resources. We have a webpage. We really encourage people to contact us with questions. Our email is on the opening slide. And now we want to just open it up to talk about how you think PACES can be integrated in our policies and in our programs, because moms and dads can't by themselves create better schools with opportunities to create hobbies and after-school activities or community groups. So this is something that we kind of are now putting it back in the court of those who are in the field, those of you who are policy makers. Certainly we owe a lot to OICA for drawing our legislators' attention and other business leaders, as does the Potts Family Foundation through their special groups that they convene legislators. But this is something that requires collective will, collective success to be able to create. So that's where we want people to leave thinking, how do we make these things happen? Not as individuals, but as a state, as communities, as neighborhoods.
Jennifer, there's a question in the chat about screening for ACEs and Nadine Burke Harris and what they're doing in California and sort of our thoughts on that. Jennifer and I think it's important to know your ACE score. It's also important to know your PACE score, but at the same time, the ACEs measure was never meant to be an individual screener. It was meant to be used as a large population level measure. So it's really important. And I think this was said earlier that this is not your destination. This is a risk factor. Do you want to say more about that, Jennifer?
Yeah, and I will point out too that when Nadine Burke Harris, who we got to meet actually in 2013 at that first ACEs summit that Amanda and I went to together in Philadelphia, she had devised a way to do it that circumvented some of the mandatory reporting requirements. So because she felt like it was important in her pediatric clinic to know what ACEs were going on, how many ACEs were going on, but not which specific ones. So she would give parents the ACEs scale and say, just give me a summary at the bottom. I'm a little leery of that. What if they write 10? You know, then you know some things are going on. Or you could write, and then you would have to report. But you might also ask people, which of these things have happened to your child in the past? And that helps open the conversation to how can I help you if they're still going on now. The mandatory reporting is important because we need to protect children. But at the same time, if it shuts off communication between you and a client or you and a patient, it can be problematic. So Amanda's right. This is something that sort of like having the knowledge of ACEs helps explain a lot and give you a pathway to look towards for improving your life, but it's never designed to give you a predictive risk just for you. Is that helpful?
Yes, thank you so much.
I think ACEs and PACEs are a nice framework for us to use as we talk about trauma-informed practices for folks, because it does lead you to the question about, you know, kind of cultivating compassionate curiosity. I wonder what happened to you rather than what's wrong with you. And it helps an individual cultivate that sort of compassion for themselves as well.
And Linda in the chat is saying that you are correct, that they do have a whole comprehensive care plan around ACEs. And that's one of the things that if people and clinics are going to ask about ACEs, they do have to have a plan for how to address them. So I do think the way that it's done in California is this whole model of comprehensive care, and they're addressing that at multiple levels. So I think
And Medicare pays for it now in California. So it is part of the pediatric model there.
Yeah. And Jennifer, and the next question is, what are the ACE related policies that we hope legislators or the legislator will implement? Do you have some thoughts on that? I know you've been working on the task force.
Well, the task force is important because it does help sensitize people to how we can re-traumatize people with some of our everyday policies and procedures if we're not mindful of being trauma-informed, of understanding what trauma does and how it might be expressed in behavior and in different ways of being. But it's not enough. I mean, certainly it's a good first step. We want people to be trauma-informed. We want people to cultivate that different approach to interacting with folks who are experienced or have experienced trauma. But I think we need to go back and say, what are we doing to raise healthy children and to support the moms and dads? Because it's really easy to take a compassionate and caring approach to a five-year-old who is looking at you with cute pigtails and a big smile. And then you see her mother who's maybe been doing drugs and prostitution, and you want to throw her away or lock her up. That's our culture. That's what we do. And rather than to have a punitive approach to parents and adults who've been caught in this vortex of adversity and then self-destructive and other kinds of behaviors, we really are going to have to say, how do we help people recover as opposed to how do we just punish people? It's a culture shift. And that's where conversations come in. You can't legislate a change in attitude, right, Joe?
Exactly.
You have to provide data. Data plus stories is what changes people's hearts and minds. So I think the more we have these kinds of meetings and conversations and get in front of our legislators and get in front of business owners and just tell stories and share numbers. And that's where I think the pandemic might have helped us a bit, because a lot of us who would never have reached out to get help from state agencies or community agencies found ourselves needing help. It's too much to try to work a 40-hour job as parents and also become a homeschooler overnight with three kids at home and not enough bandwidth to download all the assignments and not enough time. So we've all recognized that we need to be there for each other. This is a good moment in time to go out and say, how do we help each other raise the next generation? I want them to be paying into my Social Security. I don't want them to flounder as the next generation, for selfish reasons as well as for altruistic reasons.
I completely agree with you, Jennifer. I do think it's sort of changing the conversation and the way that we think about this. A lot of it's kind of an infant mental health perspective. But in the chat, there's some comments about poverty and the role that poverty plays in all of this. And I think it's very tied together. Having the resources in our state for mental health support, for supporting parents, having the basic parents having the ability to meet basic needs and basic needs around health is really a key. I will say that ACEs, you are more likely to have ACEs in an impoverished environment. However, it's not the same thing. ACEs can occur regardless of income, and it does occur regardless of financial background. Again, it's more likely if you're in poverty, but it's not necessarily the case that there it's going to be more detrimental. Jennifer and I like to talk about the ACEs, especially the relationship-based ones, the ones that are what we call the betrayal ACEs. And it doesn't matter what income level you have, if you are betrayed by someone who is supposed to be caring for you, that has negative detrimental effects. Affects how you relate to other people. It affects your stress response system. It affects your body. Not that you can't overcome that, but that's something that is separate from just having basic needs met. Poverty can compound that, but that betrayal is what we think is one of the most powerful predictors in the ACEs model.
Yeah, Nadine Burkaris likes to also point out that the difference isn't as much about ACEs between affluent and impoverished communities as it is about PACEs. Parents who live in more affluent communities, children who grew up in more middle-class homes have more access to PACEs than children whose parents are struggling to make ends meet and don't have as much time with them or as many opportunities to provide them. I'm looking over the comments also that I just love, I'm gonna give another shout out to Linda and to Cheryl and the Potts Family Foundation. The self-healing communities, I think, is critical. I think that's key when it comes grassroots up, when people in their own communities take responsibility and say, we can change this. That's the only way real change ever happens. And I love seeing how engaged so many different communities are in that initiative and linking communities with support and with resources and with research data. We don't do research to sit in a vault or to sit in a journal that five people read. We do this to gain better understanding of what works and what can get out there to in the hands of teachers and counselors and pastors and policymakers.
Well, do we have any more questions? Ladies, this has been wonderful. Thank you so much. And I wanted to make sure we ended on a positive note, and I can't think of a better way to than showing the work that y'all are doing to show those positive things that are happening to try and overcome ACEs.
We'll get there if we keep our eye on the ball. You know, if we just stay focused on this, I think we all believe that. I think it's what drives us, propels us forward every day. And it does me a lot of good to see so many other people focused on that. So thank you for inviting us and thank you for the good work you guys are doing, all of you.
And I encourage everybody to go get these and read them, and let's all work together, because this is truly the pathway of what we need to see better for these kids, and hopefully in a lot of these generational issues by getting to those in the most need right now so they don't repeat the mistakes.
Yeah, thank you, Joe.
And thank as we hear, of course, sorry to cut you off, Amanda.
I just said thank you. It's amazing the work that's being done here, and as Linda said, it's a journey. And it's much better to be doing it as a group and to have all the people who are working toward the same path.
I could not agree more. And I feel fortunate to be on this pathway with y'all and learning from each of y'all. And there's a lot that we need to do. And we're coming to a close of Fall Forum. I hope everybody has enjoyed these 4 days. Peyton has a survey that she is sending out. I did want to put over here in the chat, we're still doing our chili cook-off today, the Political Acts chili cook-off. So from 11 to 1:30 today, we have chili samples, and you can donate blood here. We'd encourage you to stop by. We've had 4 donors. We need 19. So if you can donate blood today, please share with your offices. Come over here, and it'll be more than just the normal snacks. You actually get to sample some of the chilies that we have. And you can go on the link there, and you can look at the t-shirts. Our staff is wearing those today. They turned out really cute. I will model on Zoom.
What does that say, Joe? There's no I in
quarantine.
I like it.
And then the back has all our sponsors on it for both the Fall Forum and the Chili Cook-Off. If anyone has any questions, you can call us here at the office, and I am going to put the link in the chat right now for that so everybody can sign up. Go check that out, and you can vote for the People's Choice. So we thank the eight entries, and it's been fun over here. You can watch Channel 5 KOCO in Oklahoma City tonight. They are doing a story on the Fall Forum and the Chili Cook-Off. We're making the best of what we can. And we said there's no I in quarantine. It really does feel that way sometimes. There's been an isolation feeling for all of us during the last year and a half. And as we're all moving hopefully into a better situation with more people vaccinated, people still continuing to wear a mask, doing what we can. Let's hope next year we'll be back together for Fall Forum and have a chance to really enjoy each other's company the way we truly need it, and encourage everyone to stay positive. One of the things I wrote in my column this week is I decided I needed something positive in my week because I knew we were going to be talking about some heavy things. And I binge watched Ted Lasso over the weekend. And I can't think of a better thing to do after work than to sit down and watch a couple of the episodes each night to instill a little positive feeling. Try and find those things that make you happy, because the work that we're doing, it really can impact us. We do wonderful work, but it can stress us out and hurt us sometimes. And sometimes we don't realize how much it's hurting us. So be a resource for each other, be a goldfish, don't let things linger on. And one of the things that I enjoyed most, I think, was the fact that they used Oklahoma as their word in counseling, to be completely honest. And I hope that this next year and the work that we're doing, we can force complete honesty into the conversation when we're talking about these issues at the Capitol, because we need to have that truly honest dialogue if we're going to move things forward. So Oklahoma is more than just a state. It's now a state of mind, thanks to Ted Lasso, of being honest. So hopefully we can apply that. And I hope Fall Forum has helped achieve that, and us having honest conversations over the last 4 days about where we need to be, what we need to do, and how we need each other to make that happen. So if we don't have any other business before us, there is chili to be had here in our conference room at 2915 North Classen, Suite 320. Come upstairs. The blood drive will be going till 2 p.m. Please share around with others. Come have some of the chili. Mine is the best. It hasn't been judged yet, but I know it is. Thank you, everybody, for having the time in your schedule, making the time in your schedule to share ideas, to invest in this, to be a part of the discussion. And I feel confident that when we finish up our legislative agenda based on your thoughts, we're going to have a very aggressive, comprehensive, and hopefully successful legislative agenda for 2022. So with that, we will finish up Fall Forum and wish you all a wonderful week. Thank you for the kind words over here in the chat. And please fill out your survey that Peyton sent around, and we will send it to everybody. We want to hear your thoughts to make sure that next year we have an even better Fall Forum. So thank you much.
Thank you, Joe. Thanks, everyone.